Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fifth meeting in 2017 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Could I remind, please, everyone to make sure their mobile phones are on silent? No apologies have been received. Could I ask, before we go round, because this is a lengthy session, that we do a declaration of interest from all members on all subjects?
Can we wait till we get to that item? Item one.
Well... Yeah, okay, we'll do agenda item one and we'll bring it in on agenda item two. So agenda item one is just to ask the committee whether they're content to take items five and six in private. And the committee has also asked whether consideration of the report, the draft report on climate change plan and approach paper for seatbelts on school transport bills can be taken in private at a future meeting. Is the committee a content? Yes. That's agreed then. So now I'll go to the declaration of interest before we move on and ask if there are any declarations of interest relating to agriculture and transport. Starting, Peter, I think you're the first.
Yeah, I would like to declare an interest as a partner in an agricultural business in the Northeast.
And I would declare that I am a partner of an agricultural business as well.
On the transport issue, I am an honorary vice president of Friends of the Far North Line.
Okay, Aunt Breda.
And I'll just say ditto to that. I am too.
Stuart.
I have a small registered agricultural holding. I'm president of the Scottish Association of Public Transport, vice president of Rail Future UK. And in relation to agenda items three and four, I'm the holder and user of a senior citizen's bus pass.
No, I've got nothing to say.
Thank you. So agenda item two on our agenda is the draft climate change plan for agriculture. And we're delighted to welcome the Cabinet Secretary for the Rural Economy and Connectivity to this. We have like to also record our thanks to everyone who responded to the call to evidence, and the committee received 49 written submissions. These are available on the committee's website. So we'll begin the discussion with the Cabinet Secretary, who's joined by Gordon Struth, who is the Head of Climate Change and Business Support. Now, Cabinet Secretary, I have been asked just to remind you that we have a lot of questions, as you always know when you come to this committee, and we would like to keep the answers as brief as possible. So I would ask you on the basis of that whether you'd like to make a brief opening statement before we take evidence, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, yes, I would, with your permission.
Yes,
Thank you. Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. With carbon dioxide making up only 20% of agricultural emissions, agriculture is clearly not like most other sectors. As Professor Pete Smith, who's the lead author for the IPCC in agriculture, said when he was before the committee a few weeks ago, agriculture is a more difficult sector to decarbonise because greenhouse gas emissions, other than carbon dioxide, are involved. These emissions are mostly from biological processes inherent in food production. And though some foods are lower emissions than others, there is no zero emissions food, and we all, of course, have to eat. This sector requires a distinctive approach to tackle nitrous oxide, which is 298 times worse than carbon dioxide, and methane, which is 25 times worse than carbon dioxide, and there are no easy options. Most of the steps farmers can take to reduce their emissions can only be done voluntarily. For example, government can do little to force improvements in livestock fertility, mortality, or health. We can't know the amount of fertilizer a farmer has actually applied to a field, or if it was raining when they did so. Factors such as field drainage and soil compaction are only possible to enforce at the extreme. So we need farmers to want to make these changes. And for most mitigation measures, we have no realistic means of making, enforcing, directing them so to do. The draft climate change plan sets out our approach across five policy outcomes covering all of the sources of emissions in agriculture, and we are targeting every step in the process from soil to livestock to waste and byproducts. Our role is to show farmers what changes they can make that will reduce emissions and improve their profitability at the same time. And to give them every support and encouragement. There's a significant risk that moving immediately to a regulatory approach, convener, achieves the opposite intended effect of alienating farmers and damaging their view of climate-friendly farming. If we create an impression among farmers that climate-friendly farming is something being done to them through inspections and enforcement and penalties, they will turn against all the other steps that we want them to take. We cannot significantly reduce emissions from agriculture without the goodwill of the actual custodians of the land. The good news is that most of the actions farmers can take to reduce emissions will make or save them money. What's good for the planet is therefore good for their pockets as well. I believe that engagement and encouragement will best achieve the objectives we have set out in the agriculture chapter of the draft climate change plan, building on the success of programmes such as Farming for a Better Climate and the Soil Nutrient Network. We can demonstrate to farmers and crofters that every business can have better soil, healthier crops, more productive livestock, and make the most of their waste products, because farms just like theirs have already done it and made money at the same time. There's no question that meeting our statutory emissions reduction targets will require a big effort from agriculture. It's a challenge that, with the right approach, I know the sector can meet. But it won't be achieved by working against the industry, though, and it definitely won't happen if we harm their incomes. Becoming more sustainable often means some upfront costs and risks, so you can't be green when you're in the red. I'm confident that as more and more farmers realise the benefits of improving their soil, increasing the livestock efficiency, and generating their own energy, their own renewable energy, we won't call it climate-friendly farming anymore. It will just be called farming. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary. And the first question is from Stuart.
Cabinet Secretary, you give us in your opening remarks a relatively long list of unknowns. In the light of that in particular, how did the government come up with an emission reduction target for farming, and what sector experts in particular did you consult in coming up with your target?
Well, obviously, these are, for precisely the reasons that Mr. Stevenson, convener, has just indicated, these are difficult matters to assess. I mean, some matters can be easily measured and some are more difficult to ascertain methodology and criteria for measurement. And I think, given what I've said and what you've picked up from that, I hope that, that general principle is agreed. So this is not a particularly easy task. It's quite easy to measure emissions of CO2 in other respects, and transport. It's far more difficult, I think, to conduct these measurements in farming, I would say, as a matter of principle. So we have to recognise that. But in response to the question, for the first times run, the UK marginal abatement cost curve for agriculture was used, but this wasn't designed to be used as a model, and it describes measures at farm level which cannot be delivered through policy, and some measures are undesirable for health and safety, food safety, animal welfare or environmental reasons. A revised marginal abatement cost curve was commissioned from SRUC to be used in TIMES, and that's capitals T-I-M-E-S, but this assessed abatement potential quite conservatively. Analysis by agriculture officials in dialogue with scientists, including those who produce the MACC, concluded that 500 kilotons of CO2 would be achievable through policy intervention. In addition, by analysing trends in agriculture since 1990, the baseline was revised to produce an annual 0.63% business-as-usual reduction in emissions. This is additional to the policy effort. If this reduction does not happen, then we would consider a revisal of our plans. I hope that's all crystal clear.
Long, Cabinet Secretary, so, but I'll let Stuart come back with a brief question in response.
Well, it seems to me, that listening to your answer, Cabinet Secretary, that you had three bits to this. There's the outputs from farming, and you indicated it's difficult to measure the climate outputs. So I'd be interested to know whether we've identified ways in which we can improve measuring the outputs. You also referred to the inputs, in other words, the activities that farmers can undertake. And that I understand more clearly. But also, I would want to know, do we understand clearly the effect of the inputs on the outputs? Because if we can't measure the outputs, I really wonder if we're in an area where we've got fundamental difficulties, where we need to apply ourselves or commission others to do further work to understand whether we can have outputs that actually are meaningful and cost-effective that avoid farmers moving via the green into the red, which we don't want.
I'm not certain that my scientific knowledge base is sufficient to equip me with the ability to provide an authoritative answer to what is a perfectly legitimate question. What I would say before passing to Gordon Struth to I think, supplement what I'll say and see if he can have another stab at it with your permission, conveners, just very briefly is this, that we do, of course, work, and I should pay credit and tribute to the work of contractors of the SRUC and the James Hutton Institute, and we're very fortunate to have advice of expert world-leading scientists in that regard. So the work that has been done and shaped has been shaped by experts, as well as, of course, informed by well-informed stakeholders from whom I believe the committee has already heard on these matters. So that is, I think, the correct approach to take to tackling some very difficult questions, as I think we've helpfully established. Gordon.
Yeah, it's obviously a very complex, difficult question to answer. The evidence base that we have is constantly being refined, and that can lead to some very big changes to the headline emissions statistics for Scottish agriculture. For instance, between the 2013 and 2014 statistics, which were produced in last year and the year before, there was a reduction of around 2 million tonnes of CO2 equivalent in Scottish agriculture's figures, just by improving the science behind that. A lot of that was the result of a project called the UK Greenhouse Gas Inventory Platform. It was a four-year project, £11.5 million with institutions across the UK. And this was looking at actual, real farm practice and measuring inputs and outputs on farms and research farms across the country. And that led to revisions to what we assess as the emissions that come from livestock, from slurry, from nitrogen fertiliser and so on. But we're told to expect another reasonably significant revision when the statistics are for 2015 are produced in June this year, because there's that constant process of improving the data. It's, as the Cabinet Secretary said, in other sectors you can fairly easily say that so much carbon dioxide comes from so much energy input, but in agriculture there's a lot more room for variability, and we'd basically just have to live with that.
A final wee one, if I may.
Stuart, I mean, your question, I'm going to say your question was quite long, and
this is very small.
It will need to be short, I'm afraid, Stuart.
Is this going to affect the baseline? Are we re-baselining as we understand what's going on?
Do you mean are we changing the...
Well, are we changing our view of what happened in 1990?
Yes. As they revise it, they change the figures all the way back to 1990, so it does bump the numbers around all the way back.
Takes us perfectly on to Rhoda and your question.
Yes, on the figures since 1990, any drop in greenhouse gases appears to be because of a drop in sheep and cattle numbers, and that was for financial reasons and subsidies as much as anything else. And as you said in your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary, we still eat, so that is not actually a reduction. That is maybe a displacement, maybe even abroad, from our own industry. So what actual reductions that haven't been displaced elsewhere have taken place since 1990?
Well, I'm not sure that's entirely fair to, for example, cattle farmers who are producing the same amount of milk with a substantially reduced herd. And that is through, I think, improved husbandry health and other measures. And I imagine you've probably heard of this evidence already before, but you're right to say that the numbers have been reduced, but also the efficiency, the output has, in terms of milk production, for example, has, I understand, remained about the same for quite a long period. So, but it's a fair point. And there are, I think, four main drivers for reductions in agricultural emissions since 1990. The fall in livestock numbers you've referred to, a reduction also in the amount of nitrogen fertiliser being applied, which I think is something that we would all want to see and encourage the continuance of. A reduction in the amount of land being converted from grassland to arable production, and improvement in efficiency. But it's very hard to quantify this from the annual greenhouse gas inventory. We know it's happened, and we know we get about the same amount of milk from fewer cows than in 1990. But it is difficult to quantify. But the development of emissions intensity figures, and that's one of our policies in the draft plan, will help us with this in future. And, you know, I think these are the sorts of topics that people like Jim McLaren and QMS and others are quite rightly pursuing in you know, a concerted and effective fashion. I don't know if I've covered that sufficiently comprehensively, Gordon, or is there anything else to
I just wanted to know if members know what emissions intensity refers to. Okay. This is the amount of emissions per kilo of beef, kilo of lamb, litre of milk that you get at the end. So, as the question noted, a lot of the reduction in emissions in the sector comes from a reduction in livestock numbers, which isn't necessarily a good thing. It doesn't actually necessarily reduce global emissions unless people are actually eating less, which isn't the case. So, what we want to quantify, and it's one of the policies we have in the plan, is to identify these numbers, and then what we want to see is these numbers coming down, and that'll tell us if we're being more efficient rather than if we're just getting a benefit from something else.
I mean, perhaps I should also mention, and I think this is important, and it refers back to the SRUC's role, but there has been a big effort to recruit farms through climate change focus farms, and also the provision of events which promote our attempts to persuade farmers to look at different measures. And we know that almost 1,000 farmers a year attend these events and rate them very highly, and the outcomes from these events do seem to be reasonably encouraging. And that, I think, goes back to what I said in my opening remark about encouraging, cajoling, persuading, rather than dictating, ordering, compelling, requiring. And I think that approach, I would submit, I'd be interested to hear members' views about this. I do feel that, particularly at a time of real challenges as to the future of funding for farming, for example, and I'll be meeting Andrea Leadsom tomorrow to press her on this, that, you know, farmers have got a lot to consider at the moment, and therefore I really hope that members will agree that this voluntary approach is the correct one to pursue.
Just come back very briefly on that.
Very, very briefly, because I can understand the dairy sector, but how do you reduce emissions by keeping the same outputs in the meat sector? If you reduce the outputs, the chances are you're only displacing. How do you actually do that, and how do you make that attractive to farmers?
Look at it. I mean, assuming that we all support the provision of high-quality Scotch beef and lamb, then, you know, if we stop producing beef and lamb, we're not going to stop people eating beef and lamb. We're simply going to displace the production to elsewhere. And, you know, therefore, I would suggest that there is an emissions kind of quotient in respect of all food. I mentioned that at the beginning. But I think that we should encourage farmers to continue to grow their herds, but to have regard to the various technical measures and the advice they can get from the SRUC, from James Hutton, from QMS, and from various other sources to improve the emissions intensity of their production. And that relates to matters which Gordon could probably talk about better than me.
Well, sorry, I understand that's a very important point, and actually how to get more from less is the whole issue, which is what farmers are constantly trying to achieve, and not having barren cows and having less deaths in the calves. And I understand that. And I think, Rhoda, it is a huge subject, that, and maybe something we could look at.
Could we maybe get a written response on what advice is available to farmers on how to do that?
Yeah, of course. Right. I mean, it's an enormous subject. I mean, you know, yes. In my last job, I came across the use of technology to improve the monitoring of animal health and help farmers look after their livestock, a device called Cow Alert, which enabled the measurement of the temperature of cattle and to detect those which are ill and are displaying behaviour which is symptomatic of illness, without, you know, hard-pressed farmers with perhaps very often only one other person employed on the farm, if that, having to spend all their time with visual inspection. And therefore, you know, to answer Rhoda's question, there are a variety of approaches. The use of innovative technology is absolutely key to best environmental practice, and I hope the committee has had the benefit, as I have had at AgriScot, for example, of presentations from some of the companies that are involved in promoting best green practice. by helping persuade farmers that by adopting use of modern technology, they can be greener and also be more profitable.
Gordon, can I ask, because it is such a big subject, and I'd be delighted to sit through it, but I'm frightened we're going to get short of time. Could I say that it would be useful if you could supply the committee with some of the innovative areas that you think that could help farmers reach targets?
Just one very, very brief point is that the key metric in beef production is how long the animal's alive. So if you're finishing them at, you know, nearer to 20 months than 30 months, you are using fewer cows to get the same amount of beef and reduce the emissions at the same time.
So I'm going to leave that here because it sort of neatly leads on to Gail's question, which Gail.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, Gordon. You talked a lot about encouragement and trying to take the sector along with us rather than forcing them into change. How do you think we manage that cultural change, and what do you think are the barriers to it at the moment? And what are the Scottish Government doing to show leadership, and how can we get that voluntary change?
Well, that's an absolutely fundamental question. And I do think that there's several ways to approach this. I mean, first of all, you know, one must respect the fact and recognise that farmers are the actual custodians of our landscape, and they have given it the appearance, the attractive appearance that it has, the cultivated appearance. Were it not for cultivation, for agricultural practice, we would be looking at a very different and I think far less pleasing, visually pleasing landscape. I think that farmers who are practical people are understandably sceptical about people who come along and suggest that they should suddenly depart from practices which have been pursued for generations. I mean, one must understand that, I think. And in a sense, that's a good thing. So the main thing is to try to persuade and encourage, as I've already, I think, emphasised. Moving on from that, secondly, I think that one shouldn't try to change things too quickly. I mean, one has to fit in with crop rotations. One has to fit in with breeding systems. That one can't change farming practice in the same way that one can change a productivity measures in a factory or other areas of the economy. It takes time, and it needs to be planned, not just a year ahead, but further ahead than that for many of the changes, not all of them, but many of the changes. So we're building in generations of practice. And the average farm has about 1.3 full-time equivalents. The average farmer is 58. I won't generalise about people's propensity to change as they get older, but perhaps it's more difficult to persuade. Speaking of somebody who's 59, it might be more difficult to persuade them to new ideas than when you're of a younger age. Average farm income has fallen to £23,000. So that means that any change which requires farmers to spend a lot of money, particularly at a time when, you know, we're working hard to get the farm support payments out through CAP-IT, as we've discussed for a not inconsiderable length of time. One must bear all these factors into account, I think, Convener. We won't change the culture. We have to work with it. But, and this is the positive side, that the information I have is that good environmental practice can lead to, in larger farms, savings of around the order of £10,000 a year, and even in hill farms of £3,000 a year. Now, I think evidence has been submitted to that. I'm not sticking by these figures. They might be a little bit arbitrary. But I think they are indicative of the fact of what I said earlier, that good environmental practice is good business practice if it's applied in the correct scientific way, availing themselves of advice, which in many cases is free or minimum cost, therefore, you know, I think really Gail Ross's question, Convener, seems to me to get to the nub of how we get the best outcomes, which I assume is what we are after here in the work we're doing to tackle climate change.
Okay, well, that's fine, thanks.
The next question is John Finney. Oh, sorry. Peter, yep. Yeah, well, I think you, John, you were starting, I think,
on,
and you had a follow up, Peter.
Six here we're talking about.
Yes.
Yes, thank you. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. The question I'd planned to ask, you've largely answered, not just with your opening statement, but with subsequent comments. And it does relate to the draft plan, and at 12%, the smallest reductions of emissions in all the sectors. Now, we've heard from the witnesses that the agricultural sector may have got off lightly, as they've said. Indeed, Peter Smith of Nourish Scotland said they did get off lightly. Can you briefly again say why agriculture has been allocated the smallest reduction in emissions and why the targets aren't more ambitious?
Well, I think it's on the face of it a fair question, but I think it was Mr. Smith, it's the gentleman from Aberdeen.
Nourish. The food.
Nourish, yes. Witness from
Pete Smith.
Yes.
Who said, pointed out that the emissions of carbon dioxide are far less significant in agriculture. It's, as I've said, it's nitrous oxide, it's other emissions. And therefore, one is not really looking at tackling CO2 emissions, which has been the particular focus in other sectoral areas and other parts of the climate change plan. The second point I make, Convener, is that reducing emissions in how we produce our food is very hard to do. And I think that has to be, we have to live in the real world. If we don't, we won't succeed. If we advocate measures which are impracticable and undeliverable, it seems to me we are only likely to fail. We're also, thirdly, constrained by our land and our climate. So it is obviously we have prime arable land, but not a great proportion. I think about 8% in Scotland. Much of the land can only be used for rough grazing. And especially in areas such as the Highlands and Islands or Shetland, where I was visiting and spoke to farmers on Monday of this week. So there's limitations on the land and the climate about how we can use land and indeed how we should use land. I mean, you know, you cannot grow barley or wheat in upland hill areas, which are suitable only for sheep, and so on and so forth. These are matters not for me, these are matters for farmers, as the farmers in the committee will, I'm sure, agree. The easiest way to reduce emissions from agriculture would be to reduce output, but as I've explained, that would simply lead, Convener, to more food being imported, and it would not reduce the emissions globally, it would simply transport them elsewhere. And I wouldn't have thought that is a practice that anyone would wish to support. I don't know are there other aspects of this, Gordon, that you would want to cover, please?
I think a couple of things that are very worth flagging up are that in a March 2014 report by the US Environmental Protection Agency, they examined what's the technical potential for mitigation from agriculture globally, and they concluded that from livestock you could reduce emissions by 10% and from cropland by 12%. So the opportunities to reduce emissions significantly from agriculture are very limited. Another important factor when you're looking at the statistics and what share falls in what sector is that the agriculture sector doesn't include a lot of the things that farmers are already doing on the plus side of the balance sheet. So in particular, peatland restoration, forestry and generating renewable energy, which is all, you know, major agricultural activities that aren't counted in there. So it's worth noticing that as a whole, land use in Scotland is about net zero emissions at the moment. And with 70% of the land in Scotland being agriculture, they're obviously playing a very big part on that side of the equation as well. It just doesn't come through in the statistics.
Yes.
Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. There's five tables in agriculture in the plan there, pages 142 to 149, policy outcomes over time. Said. Now, every table just repeats a set of unquantified statements, and that starkly contrasts with, for instance, the transport sector, where there are specific targets each year that mean something. I wonder, will you commit to looking at that in the draft plan and coming back with more specific and measurable policies?
I'm very happy to, and we will look at any matters that the committee indicate are areas of where we can make further progress. So, you know, I would undertake happily to do that. And if we can come up with anything that's more specific on any matters then that would be a positive step. But I have found the quote that I was it was in the cranial area from my early morning research, and it was indeed from Pete Smith, and it simply said, agriculture is a more difficult sector to decarbonise because greenhouse gas emissions other than carbon dioxide are involved. And he goes on to make many of the points that I did cover about nitrous oxide and methane are components, and it's more challenging to reduce those emissions. So I think I was actually making the points without necessarily locating the quotation, which I've now done.
I'll just say that we have that quotation in our briefing paper.
So it was a very good one. So
it was an interesting one. So maybe you could take it that
I've got some other ones here as well.
Well, I think we've probably got both those. So we may thank you for not repeating those quotations, if I may. John, can I move on to Peter, who's got it? Have you got a supplementary there?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I would just say I certainly welcome. You asked what the opinion of the committee is, and I can tell you mine. I think the collaborative approach rather than compulsion is absolutely the right way to go with this. And it is very important that we stress that, you know, cutting down on CO2 emissions is actually is a good way to save money on the farm as well. That, you know, the two things go hand in hand, and we need to keep stressing that. And that's a way to get buy-in from farmers, in my opinion. My supplementary has actually been pretty well answered. I mean, what I was going to say is, you know, the 12% reduction may look small, but you go out and answer the thing. And, you know, what about the fact that farmers plant trees and have wind farms and are doing peat restoration work? Why doesn't that part of the equation come into the calculation as well? I fear we're being somewhat unfair if we ignore that part of the agricultural equation as far as greenhouse gases are concerned. So it's probably been answered, but I just wanted to make the point.
Comment on that, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't know if I've replied thus to Mr. Chapman in this session of Parliament, but I totally agree with what he's just said. And I think the points were actually well made by Andrew Bower. I won't quote him because you want me to do that, but I think it is absolutely a well-made point that farmers are doing a lot of other things in respect of forestry, peatland, environmental works, and of course renewables. And I mean, places like Orkney and the North East, a very substantial number of farmers have invested in renewables. It's a tragedy that the UK government have removed the support for renewables and fit tariffs and ROCs, because that process was really, really starting to motor on. What a tragedy that happened. But I do agree with Mr. Chapman that, you know, the contribution that farmers are making to climate change needs to factor in all these other matters. And I was very pleased that Andrew Bower of the NFU Scotland made that point. And I'm sure the committee will want to reflect that. Perhaps somehow we can give farmers credit for that in the agriculture section of the climate change plan if we don't already do so. I don't know, Gordon, if you can add anything there.
We can do so. I think it's just simply a case that you have to decide where you're going to draw the lines when you're producing statistics, and that's what we do. But we can certainly produce a sort of side note that explains the contribution that agriculture makes in these ways.
Happy to move on. The next question, Cabinet Secretary, is actually from me regarding soil. And we've had a lot of evidence on the requirement for keeping the soils healthy, and we're thankful for the letter that you made available to us regarding that. Now, there has been some talk about making soil testing compulsory sooner rather than later. I actually favour the response that you've taken, which is perhaps dangerous, that you've agreed with Peter, and I'm now agreeing with you. But could you just explain to me, if it was to go compulsory, how you think that could be implemented if farmers don't buy in, and considering the variability of monitoring soils, i.e. if you put lime on today, if you get bad weather tomorrow, it might not have the same effect. So do you see there's any way that it could be made compulsory, or are you wedded to the idea of voluntary taking farmers along with you on it?
Well, I suppose, I mean, it would be possible to make this compulsory. I mean, that would be possible to do by regulation. But my approach to this is that were we to do that, I actually think then that we might we might see the opposite consequence to that that we all wish to see. We all wish to see a reduction in emissions. But to do that, we do need to persuade, I think, farmers that this is a good thing to do, both for the planet and the pocket. And there are signs. So I think we do very much agree, Convener. I do appreciate that, because in politics we don't need to disagree all the time about everything. So that's encouraging. But there is the second point I make is that we're not starting from a standing start. You know, a great many farmers already see the sense of soil testing. A great number, a cohort, if you like, are already adopting soil testing. And they're doing so because they've discovered that it's good business practice as well as doing right by the environment. And, I mean, I don't know any farmers who want to trash their farm and trash the environment. Quite the opposite. I mean, as one of them put it in Farmer and Pressure, I have to wake up and look at it every day. You know, I mean, I care about it more than anyone else, he said. And I think one must always bear that in mind, that, you know, people like myself, a humble lawyer from Glasgow, is not particularly well placed to start to dictate to farmers and expect them to do anything other than say, well, thank you very much and good night. So I think the voluntary approach is correct. But just let me quote some of the figures, that 30% of farmers in grassland and 64% of farmers in other land, according to the Scottish Survey of Farm Structure and Methods 2016, said that they had tested soil in the last year. It's unlikely that they may mean that they tested all of their improved land. The British Survey of Fertiliser Practice 2015 shows that only 34.7% of tillage and 8% of grassland had any sort of pH test performed on it. Now, Rosanna Cunningham has made the very valid point that, you know, why would you apply nitrogen to soil without knowing the pH? You know, what's the point of applying lots of extra nitrogen when it's not required? And if you don't know what the pH level is, how do you know that you're applying the right quantity? And I thought that was a very practical exposition of the case for testing. Therefore, for those reasons and others, I believe that a voluntary approach is correct, precisely because it's more likely to lead to a better outcome at the end of the day. And it's already being taken up by farmers. And my impression, and this is the last thing I'll make before passing to Gordon, see if I've missed anything, but the impression I get is that the best person to persuade a farmer to do something is perhaps another farmer, you know, on a demonstration farm, a monitor farm, or that. And these developments are very, very encouraging at the moment, where there's lots of consideration about these kind of matters. So I think it's already happening, and we're encouraging further take-up of a process which has now started to be seen by many farmers as the right one. Gordon.
Yes, I think you covered almost everything that I would say there. One thing I would add, and it's very important to remember, is that soil testing in and of itself doesn't reduce emissions. It's what the farmer then does afterwards that reduces emissions. So we do have realistic mechanisms. We could force farmers to test. We couldn't force them to then do anything with the result of that test, and nor could we force them to test well. As you recognise, there's the variability in climatic conditions can lead to differences in the results. You know, the aim of soil testing is to get farmers to know their pH and know that they may be losing money if they're applying nitrogen fertiliser. But then that next stage of improving the pH is something that we would realistically never be able to make them do, which is why it's important to not to alienate farmers and not to make them feel this is something being forced on them.
Before I pass on to Stuart, I'd just make the observation which hasn't been made is that you can't change a soil structure and soil nutrients overnight. So many farmers will do it over a period of time. Sorry, Stuart.
I think this comes into the category of that's all very well, but the figures that you've provided, Cabinet Secretary, to the Environment Committee show 26% of arable farm meeting the pH targets and 27% on grass. So clearly there is more to be done. I just wonder, given that we've already established under Pillar 2 support that it's right to reward farmers for particular behaviours. Is there scope within that sort of approach to try and up the ante on this? Because 26 and 27%, if I understand them as a non-farmer, don't sound terribly encouraging, I have to say. And that we certainly shouldn't at this stage, maybe you as minister would wish to, but I suspect I wouldn't, considering that in the longer term, moving to penalties if things don't happen.
So grants for soil testing. I think is the question, Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not going to commit to spending any more money on anything here, so sorry about that, but that's going to be the answer. But I also think we have to just bear in mind that the overall funding support mechanism is complex enough. In fact, I think speaking to Scottish Agronomy yesterday, speaking to the NFU recently, one thing that just about every single farmer agrees on at the moment, no matter what they're doing, is the current system is too complex. Whatever else is going to happen in future, I think we just must bear in mind that. Of course, we want to be as helpful as possible in relation to enabling take-up, but it does seem to me that, you know, if it is the case, I have been persuaded that in principle, perhaps not for every farm, but for many, many farmers, it is the case that it is a profitable activity to undertake a soil test as a precursor to adopting improved practices. Then if it is profitable, then I think one should conclude this as a kind of steward of public money, that if it is profitable, then perhaps a grant finance is not something that should be necessarily disbursed to support it, but I'm just talking in general terms. We're not ruling anything out, convener, but I think at the moment we're not starting from zero. We're starting from quite a large base, and it seems to me that there is a very good prospect over the next few years to persuade a very substantial number of farmers to increase their uptake. The last thing I would say is, I've tried this I've gone over this line of encouragement rather than direction quite a lot recently at various farmers' audiences. I am absolutely convinced that this is the best way to achieve our objectives. And were we to go down a different route, I think it would be likely to have a perverse result of making things much more difficult and creating a lot of resentment and perhaps even opposition or further opposition to what we're trying to achieve.
Cabinet Secretary, I think in your letter you said it was 2023 that you'd review that. Maybe I hope I've got that correct. Would there be a trigger point before that if you hadn't seen sufficient change in the industry before that, or are you happy to review it at that date?
I'd be very happy to serve another term and review it at that date.
Suggest that it would go to 2023. We could discuss that, and I think that might not be helpful. But
I do think, to be serious, it's a perfectly reasonable question.
Is there a trigger point?
I do think that there shouldn't be a trigger point set at the moment. I mean, I think it would be a bit silly to say, let's work with the grain, let's get buy-in, and then it's at the same time say, but by the way, if you don't buy in and if you don't do what we want, we're going to hit you over the head with regulations in 3 years or 4 years. I really don't think that would do anything other than be seen as inimical to the voluntary sort of engagement approach. So I don't think that, and I know that the Environment Committee has quite fairly pursued this point as well, and I will be replying to them very quickly. But I really don't think we should say, on the one hand, we want to work with you, and on the other hand say, and if you don't do what we want, we're going to tell you what to do. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense. And for that reason, I wouldn't be supporting it in 2023.
Okay, Peter's got a quick follow-up.
Just to clarify the issue of soil testing, I mean, we've got to recognise that this is really only applicable on arable soils and improved grassland. You know, the vast bulk of Scotland is severely disadvantaged, hill ground, which doesn't receive any fertiliser at any time. So there is no need to be soil testing that land. It's really the better quality land, and it should be done in the better quality land. But that needs to be, that needs to be recognised that there are big chunks of Scotland that it doesn't apply.
Secretary, if you could acknowledge that statement, and maybe, Peter, I could ask you to move on to the next question, which is regarding tenant farmers. I'm just conscious of time, Peter.
Tenant farmers have been particularly targeted in the plan, Why do you feel that is necessary? Why do you feel that we need to particularly speak about tenant farmers in this context?
Well, I think that, you know, for obvious reasons, tenant farmers who don't get all the benefit of investment necessarily that they make into their farms will be less inclined to make a capital investment of any sort, because the return would then perhaps be shared between themselves and the landlord. So there is that very basic factor that one must bear in mind. I mean, I'm absolutely determined that we do not leave behind tenant farmers in any way whatsoever. We must consider how we can assist them to avail themselves of the same opportunities as owners, and see that they're reasonably compensated for so doing. And of course, that relates to other matters that we're not concerned with directly here today, namely the law of agricultural holdings and the reform thereof. But the measures we want are good for profitability, but they do require an initial investment and then be paid off in the following years. And we do think that tenant farmers can be discouraged from implementing these measures because they fear their tenancy may end before, you know, the benefits arise. And that's a perfectly understandable and indeed prudent business consideration to bear in mind before one makes any investment as a tenant farmer. So we will work with the continue to work with the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association, whose annual dinner I'm attending this Saturday, looking forward to, at the excellent Hunting Tower Hotel. And we will explore in the course of that pleasant dinner how best we can help tenant farmers avail themselves of the manifold opportunities under the climate change.
Secretary, because I'm sure by mentioning the name of the hotel and who's hosting you won't get you any more free drinks. I'm sure they'll be free anyway. But Peter, do you want to follow that up?
I just wonder if the Scottish Government have any plans to deal with the long-term challenge of ensuring that soil fertility is factored into the short-term nature of tenant farming. You know, there is an issue there, and you rightly point out, but are there any plans in place to address some of that perceived imbalance?
Well, you know, we've just come up with a draft plan. It really was. I want to emphasise this committee. This has involved a huge amount of work by all cabinet secretaries. It involved almost the whole of the time for the first week back in this session and a lot of previous time. And I'm absolutely determined, as I say, that tenant farmers are not left out. But it's a difficult thing. I think it's inherently more difficult to see how tenant farmers would be encouraged readily to take up these measures because of the reasons that I've identified. And that's precisely why, you know, I need to hear from them on how best to pursue and what options there are that would best encourage tenant farmers, given the matters I've raised, convener.
I think it's probably fair to leave it there that we'll see some changes in the WAGO valuation, which will allow tenants to claim for the work they've done for the soil, or to be held accountable if they've taken nutrients out. John, I think no, sorry, it was Richard who's next.
Secretary, policy outcome 3 is to work with Quality Meat Scotland and others to reduce emissions from the red meat and dairy sector. What way do you expect working with Quality Meat Scotland will reduce emissions, and in order to ease time, can you also answer the other question would be, Quality Meat Scotland doesn't cover the dairy sector. What would you do? Have you any plans to improve emissions intensity in this area?
As Mr. Lyle quite rightly says, we will continue to work closely with Quality Meat Scotland, and I recently had the pleasure of attending one of their board meetings, and others, of course, to reduce emissions from livestock farming, and their focus is resolute on improving the efficiency of production. And one of Scotland's real strengths is the quality of Scotch beef and Scotch lamb, and that's something that QMS are doing a great job in promoting. They are pursuing a number of initiatives. For example, the Monitor Farm initiatives are the perfect place to demonstrate best practice, best environmental practice. And I was very encouraged to see that the numbers of visitors to Monitor Farms around the country has been absolutely enormous. The interest has been enormous. As I learned at lunch yesterday at St Etel with the Scottish Agronomy, a farmers' a cooperative of around, I think, about 100 cereal arable farmers, they have had an equivalent measure to the monitor farms themselves, I think, since 1990 or thereabouts, or the late 80s. So, in other words, the best way is what I've said before. It's for bodies such as QMS to work closely with different types of farmers in order to encourage the take-up of best practice. On policy, we will this year publish emissions intensity figures, now that we're all acquainted with this concept that we may not previously have been too intimate with, of emissions intensity. So these figures will be published for beef, lamb and milk this year. And by working with QMS and livestock producers and the meat wholesale body that work closely with and do a good job, will encourage improved emissions intensity through genotyping, improving fertility, reducing mortality, as Gordon has already referred to, and by improving farm management practices.
Cabinet Secretary, did you give the answer on dairy, bringing that in? Or sorry, did I miss that?
I didn't answer that, I'm very sorry, but perhaps Gordon could answer that.
Sure. Yeah, so I think a lot of our policies will be a benefit to dairy farmers anyway, so those on soil, get the most from your grass, livestock health in particular, obviously, and on slurry and manure management will benefit the dairy sector. Two of our climate change focused farms are dairies at the moment, but one of the things that struck us is that there's the dairy sector has been delivering year-on-year efficiency improvements for over a number of years, and there's actually a lot we can learn from that sector as well to share with others.
I think Cabinet Secretary made it that we actually have less cows, but the farmers are producing more milk. How is that?
The animals are simply more productive. You just get more milk out of them. So through selective breeding from generation to generation, a lot of that has to be based on milk recording. So you have to record the individual milk yields of animals and then do the genetic work through, you know, what were the good genetic lines there on the bull side and as well as on the cow side. And then just very carefully breeding that up. Also a lot of work on livestock health, on tackling the kind of big problems in dairy side like mastitis and so on. They've really been able to every year basically be able to find these improvements.
That's interesting. Thank you.
Well, I think you've got a supplementary.
I do, yeah, thanks, convener. Cabinet Secretary, can we just touch on the beef efficiency scheme, if I may? There was a recent report saying that the take up has been relatively low. I just wonder if you could tell us what you hope to achieve from it. Why do you think the take up has been so low? What can be done to encourage farmers to participate, and will it be open to applicants this year?
Well, obviously the beef efficiency scheme is just in its infancy, and it's an agri environment measure within the SRDP of 2014 and 2020. Although Gail Ross refers to the take up as being low, although the figure is just over 2,000, I think it's the case that the applicants, that figure may sound low, but I think the applicants cover around about half of the total Scottish herd. So plainly it's the farmers with larger herds that have tended to apply and perhaps more readily see the benefits of the scheme, and one can understand that that's the case. And it's the number of livestock that are in the scheme that counts. That's, you know, from an emissions point of view, the more animals that are in, the more cows that are in the scheme, the better the potential for emission reduction will be. So it's early days yet. We do think that in relation to its impact in climate change, it will drive reductions in greenhouse gases from the livestock sector, and that the practices, and I've got the practices all here in a note. Probably yourself, Mr. Chapman, would understand them better than me, but so I probably won't go into them and read them out, if you don't mind, Convener. But they are all designed to generate reductions in the amount of greenhouse gases, as well as improve productivity and efficiency. And I think you know the best way to see a greater take-up of the scheme is the success of the first cohort of applicants going through the scheme. I think that's undoubtedly the case. As to the question of whether there'll be a further round later, I mean, obviously we look at this, and what I tend to do, conveners, is have discussions with the farming community, particularly with the NFUS, the Crofting Foundation, before we come to decisions, rather than tell them about it after we've made them. So I kind of want to get a very clear understanding of the facts, and it is early days yet. I mean, you know, the tags are all out to applicants. The NFUS sent a business guide update to January. It's early days yet. I think it's probably sensible to get a good kind of take on how matters are going before we make further decisions. But I hope to do that fairly soon, and I'm happy, of course, to keep the committee informed about that if it so wishes.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Can I just a quick follow up on that? Is the crofting bull scheme obviously providing bulls to crofters is a useful scheme in the Highlands and an important one. Can you just confirm to me, Cabinet Secretary, that it is actually increasing the standard of livestock on crofts, and any ways that you're measuring that to ensure that they are playing their part in greenhouse gas emission as well?
Well, that's, I mean, I over the years, say, the crofting areas bull scheme has been the subject of much debate and consideration in this place for good reasons. And it has performed a very important function, obviously, to a livestock cattle holders in the islands, particularly the Hebrides. So it's a very important scheme. I haven't particularly looked at it from this point of view, but perhaps, unless, Gordon, you've got the scheme about the emissions impact of the crofting bulls at your fingertips, we could undertake to come back to the committee with it. It's a perfectly reasonable question.
To know that the bulls are helping crofters get the best from their cattle and therefore put the best into the environment. And I'm going to leave it there, if I may, Cabinet Secretary, and ask John to do the final question before we take a break to sort of move on to forestry.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, one of the pages I liked in the plan was page 139, which is wider impacts, and then you've got a section on adverse side effects to be managed. And one at 14.4.6, it says, improved profitability could encourage greater intensification in farming with resultant negative impacts on biodiversity. This is not expected to happen, but it is a possibility. I wonder if you could comment. I mean, do you think there are real risks in there, or are you totally relaxed about it?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand what...
Right, it's page 139. Right. And it's 14.4.6.
Do you want to...
Yeah, I
answer that, Gordon.
Should answer that, because it was my analysis. I mean, really, this was trying to consider all the wider potential benefits, of which there are clearly many, but also the risks as well. So one of the generally identified risks, if you're trying to drive farmers towards greater efficiency, is that they'll push their land harder, and there could be... there could be negative consequences from that, which we would hope that are offset by our other Pillar 2 arrangements and our environmental regulation and so on. So it was only really identified as a potential risk rather than something that we actually expect to happen, but it's something we would keep an eye out for. To give you one example of the sort of thing that can happen, if in areas of more high nature value farming, farmers there were to improve their grassland, it would lead to a reduction in the biodiversity in the grasses. So there's these are risks that are possible that can happen, but and it's something we'll keep an eye on, but we don't assess it as being likely.
Okay, I think that Cabinet Secretary concludes the questions on agriculture. I'd like to just briefly suspend the meeting, and I'd ask members of the committee to stay seated just so we can adjust the support team that the Cabinet Secretary has. Can I thank Gordon for the help and the evidence you've given this morning at the committee? Okay. I'll briefly suspend the meeting.
Okay. Right, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to continue with the discussion on forestry, and the Cabinet Secretary has been joined by Joe O'Hara, Head of Forestry Commission Scotland. Welcome again to you. And the first question is actually from you, Richard, I think.
Yeah, thank you. Cabinet Secretary, at the weekend I actually had the enjoyment of going through a boy in Aberdeenshire, Mankery, Ballater, and all the lovely forests that we have in Scotland. We have 1.44 million hectares of woodland, accounting for 18% of the total land area. Trees absorb carbon dioxide and store carbon as organic matter, such as the act negative emitters of greenhouse gases. So it's not rocket science to know that we need to plant more in order to help. Why are we not doing that? Why are we not encouraging more planting by anyone? Some of these forests that I went by, I saw land which could be planted on. Why is that not happening?
Well, I think a lot is happening to achieve our targets. I had prepared an opening statement, Convener, but there we are. But you know, I would have covered all that and set the context. But
well, I think maybe.
I'm happy to give you nice answers if we push on with
the questions, Cabinet Secretary, and then if there's anything that we've missed from your opening statement, you could bring it up as a closing statement.
Okay. Well, we're doing. You know, I'm absolutely determined to achieve the targets, and they are stretching, but targets should be stretching. The targets are also stepped. The target at the moment is 10,000. It's increasing to 15,000, but that's in a stepped approach. And I think you've got the details of the step up, which will start to apply, I think, from the beginning of the next decade. And there's a huge number of things we're doing to see that we achieve the targets. But first of all, we're not starting from a fail. We've achieved an average of 6,800 hectares a year, target's 10,000. So since 2013, we've achieved 6,800. That's 68%. That was better than the examination marks I got in most of the subjects I did at school, Convener. So we're not starting from, you know, a fail, but we haven't done well enough. And that, you know, let's just not beat about the bush. And that's the starting point. So what are we doing? Well, we're doing a whole load of things. First of all, at my instigation, we've increased the amount of money to be spent on grants, and that's very important, and that's gone up to, I think, £34 million. And secondly, we're streamlining the approval process in the Jim McKinnon report, and I think I was delighted that Jim's report got buy-in, I think, from really across the whole spectrum of interests. No one saw this as, you know, as something that was skewed in any way to one group. And he was the former chief planner, of course, in the Scottish Government. So, you know, he was coming from a position of authority and knowledge. And thirdly, we're taking forward the delivery plan. We've published the delivery plan. There are work streams that are going forward to deliver this. Now, how is this going to help? Well, sometimes, particularly for a larger forestry convener, it just takes a bit too long for the process. In some cases, horrendously long. But in defence of the Forestry Commission, the averages are quite good, and Joe can cover them, and the averages are good, and we want to see them increase. And thirdly, we are, and I have just announced this on Monday, we have announced additional funds, additional £5 million in this next year's budget to address the timber transport challenge. And therefore, that will help, particularly in difficult, inaccessible areas in the Highlands, for example. And it's not just roads either. There's many other schemes, and I can give lots of examples if you wish, in relation to use of rail or marine access, because some areas like Ardnamurchan, it's very, very difficult to use single-track roads or impossible for forestry lorries. You need to consider a marine solution. So it's not just for roads, although it'd be primarily for roads, I guess. So we've done that. In addition to that, we've got specific plans where we're working with, for example, sheep farmers. We've got a concerted plan doing that, a separate one for crofters. We are also through the conservancies, and I met one of the conservancies, I think the Stirlingshire one, Keith...
Central Scotland. Yeah.
Keith
Wishart.
Wishart. And he informed me about an excellent scheme. And let me just share this with you, because, you know, it's very good to put this in evidence about the actual work on the ground being done to address Mr. Lyle's absolutely apposite question. That is this, that The Forestry Commission have secured the services of experts in land management to go and visit individual farmers to inspect their farms with a view to ascertaining, giving advice about which portions of land on a given farm may be suitable for woodland creation. And then, after an inspection with the farmer, obviously, going round his or her farm, they have a discussion, probably in the farmhouse kitchen, and that has had, and I don't want to give you the figure, I know what the figure is, but the take-up of farmers from this direct approach has been a take-up that any salesman would wish for in his or her dreams. And you would expect that to be the case because, you know, how do you persuade a farmer to do something? Well, plainly, you need to show the farmer that you understand the facts, you understand the farm, go around the farm, identify which areas are appropriate for silviculture, if any, and then have a discussion about the finances, the feasibility, and the practicalities. So, you know, practical schemes like that are what drives me forward as a Cabinet Secretary, and I've asked every conservancy to consider whether, you know, they are already doing such a scheme or could wish to do so. Because you're absolutely right that, you know, farming and forestry used to be seen as almost opposites, and in some cases with an element of antipathy. Our proposition is that they can be complementary, and that one doesn't need to afforest the whole of a farm, a proportion of a farm, and that allows for certain benefits, financial business benefits, diversification, long-term investment, improved environmental performance, of course, and we are therefore doing all of those things. We also have had two forestry summits, one in the south of Scotland and one in a boat of Garten in the Highlands to bring people together. I've also met with the trade unions, representatives of the staff of the Forestry Commission, because, you know, I want to absolutely give the assurance that we will need, if anything, more people to be working overall in the sector rather than fewer. And I've also been working quite rightly with the NGOs, the environmental bodies, and Joe has been doing a great job on that as well, and also in relation to the way in which the private and public sector can work together, and also in respect of promotion of community ownership where appropriate. That's something that we very much want to encourage. The key for all of this is collaboration, but I'm satisfied that we have set a tone, set a new positive tone that has energised the sector. And if I might pass to Joe, perhaps, Joe, you can remind me of the statistics which have absented themselves from my cranial area about the
Cabinet Secretary, before we do, Richard's actually got, a follow-up, which may help to launch at this stage, so Joe can answer that as well.
Yeah, very briefly, you know, at the end of the day, and you anticipated actually my next question is, how much encouragement are we doing for people to look at the land that they own and land that they can come forward to the government? So you're actively going out now to encourage people to start planting. Yes?
A massive amount.
Yes. And it's also, to reflect the Cabinet Secretary's point, it's this business about, this isn't just down to government, it's not just down to my team of 50 or so woodland officers. This needs to be a concerted effort across the piece. So we're working with Confor members, with agents, encouraging them. If we're at a show or something and we can identify opportunities that then the agents can follow up and go and speak to farmers, and we're listening to farmers who might be, so, for example, last week in the Scottish Farmer, we had a piece in about if people are looking at their land, thinking about the future, what role can trees play, what grants can we offer on that? And we've had very good feedback on that piece. So it's a broad church of activities, and I think the example that Cabinet Secretary gave for Central Scotland is another example of the sort of thing we do. But my guys, there's not enough of us. We can't do all of that with all of the 33,000 farmers across Scotland. It needs a broadly based approach, and that's exactly what we're trying to do with NSA, NFU and others.
Ask a follow-up on that, because some farmers will look to relatively small-scale schemes, and certainly experience in the past tells me that the smaller the scheme, the bigger the consultation, the higher the costs,
and the more difficult it is. Are you addressing that? And I don't want to take away from Peter's next question, which I think which will be on the McKinnon report. But can I just have confirmation small schemes are up for grabs as well?
Yeah, small schemes are included where they're appropriate, but we have specifically targeted areas of 10 hectares or more because we think that's the best thing for the farmer because they're not only getting the agronomic benefits in terms of animal welfare, shelter and animal health and potentially water and carbon, but also at that scale, you're likely to get a better crop at the end of the day because below 10 hectares, the edge effects are so great that the trees you're growing aren't potentially good for timber. So we're focusing, and the work we've been doing with NSA and the NFU is specifically focusing on that 10 to 50 hectare size of blocks because we think that's the right way to go. The very small areas, the fencing costs are so high that the bang for your buck is quite low. So they're still in there and they're still appropriate in some cases, but I think we're looking at that 10 hectare plus area.
Peter, I think the next question is yours.
Yeah, well, I'm delighted that we're pushing forward on this issue. One of the big blockages, I think, to getting more planting has been the perception that it's very difficult to apply for grant. There's a lot of red tape. There's a huge cost involved just to go through that process and get permission to plant. And I very much welcome the McKinnon report that came out just recently, and I just would like your comment on that. How quickly are you going to take forward the useful targets that the McKinnon reported, and how he said that we could simplify the whole process?
Well, thanks, and I appreciate those sentiments, which I entirely share. And the review, Jim's review, was warmly welcomed by the forestry sector. He set out 20 recommendations. We accept all of them in principle. His report was published in December last year. A delivery plan composed of a series of work streams was published on the 10th of this month, and that included a timetable. A delivery group has been set up. This involves members from the forestry industry and environmental bodies. And this has been set up to take forward the recommendations, as I think is prudent and sensible. So, you know, I, like Mr. Chapman, like I suspect everybody, felt we need to get on with this. You know, we need to get on with this, and we need to do so quickly. And it's a complex issue, involves many, many factors. But the McKinnon report identified certain causes for perhaps unnecessary delays in the process, unnecessary complications, and his recommendations, which the committee will have seen as 20 recommendations, I think have been really warmly welcomed, as have been his presentations of the report. The last thing I'd say is that the current approval times for woodland creation are 16 weeks on average and 12 weeks for FGS applications that don't require a 28-day consultation period. So, you know, that is good, and I think it's important that I don't impliedly, you know, sort of trash the the reputation of conservatives and others who are working hard, and many of whom I met at an event recently at Sylvan House. They're doing a great job, but we think a better job can be done. And actually, many of the problems that we encountered really weren't their issue. I mean, obviously, with any application, you need a good quality application. You know, whether it's for a new housing development, a wind farm, or a forest. I mean, it needs to be well prepared by professionals. That's not necessarily always the case. We shouldn't just assume that it's always the public sector that is sort of slipping up or to be criticised or found at fault in some way. It's most certainly not. Secondly, there are many other bodies, statutory bodies, SNH and so on, who have a role to play. And obviously, we need to make sure that all these bodies play their job, play their role, and do their job in an effective, speedy, timeless fashion. And I'm absolutely determined that is exactly what will happen. The complex cases, and I think you alluded to this, Convener, particularly over 500 hectares, which involve environmental assessments, they can take much longer. They were the main focus of the review because, you know, if we are to achieve the target, plainly we do need to see large projects going ahead, as well as welcome more modest scale developments. And Jim's recommendations were particularly focused on that, because that is where the delays occurred in the larger schemes, more complex, perhaps involving elements of controversy with communities and so on. And therefore, Jim's report focused on that, and I think it will make a substantial difference, primarily because of the very warm reception that it appears to have received. I don't know if, Joe, if you have anything to add to that.
Yeah, in fact, all of my Conservancy staff are at a meeting today. I couldn't be with them because I was here going through the delivery plan, so setting up the work streams for the delivery plan. And we have the first meeting of the delivery group with the externals is on the 3rd of March. So we are cracking on. Some of the recommendations we will be able to implement very quickly. Others, we're going to need to take a bit more working through because we know there have been concerns raised by the sector of absolutely the direction of travel and the outcomes. We're all behind that. Some of the details we'll need to work through and decide when and how is the best way to implement them. But that's all very much... We're very focused on that at the moment across the Commission.
I mean, that's all very positive, of course it is. But what comment do you have on the recent opposition to planting targets? It's come from the Scottish Gamekeepers Association and Mountaineering Scotland. They've both said that they are against increased planting targets.
Well, I did notice the publicity, which stretched over 2 days. There was the sort of first half and the second half. The first half was a joint statement, I think, with the two bodies. The second half was criticism of the joint statement by members of one of the bodies, at least. So it didn't seem to me that there was necessarily a process of the choral singing from the same hymn sheet, or even the same hymnary, perhaps. But addressing the substance of the matter, the SGA and the MCS did not oppose the targets in themselves, I understand. But they were concerned about tree planting on moorland. And we have received, I think, in principle, support for our plans from a wide range of stakeholders, from the private sector and environment, such as Confor representing many of the business bodies in the timber sector, such as the Scottish Wildlife Trust, such as the NFUS. So we have had quite a lot of buy-in, I think, across the range from the general targets. And, of course, the WWF have pointed in their report last year to the you know, indisputable need in the UK for there to be more trees grown if we're to meet our needs. And if we don't, 80% of our timber needs will have to be imported by 2050. I mean, that would be a staggering indictment of failure were that to occur. And I'm determined that it won't, that it should not occur so far as this part of the UK is, these part of the UK is concerned. So, you know, I think that woodland creation, in conclusion, needs to be taken forward in a sustainable way, observing good silvicultural practice. We're not short of moorland. There is a lot of it. It's a matter of balance, what the right approaches, the right trees in the right place, not to take a doctrinaire, generalised approach. That doesn't really work with forestry. And the last point I make is, you know, there'll be no going back to the bad days of you know, serried ranks of sitka spruce across deep peatland. I mean, that, I think, did arouse, understandably, strong opposition. That couldn't happen now, incidentally, because of the approved FCS accreditation scheme. So it simply couldn't happen now for various reasons that Joe can explain far better than I. But there is sufficient room in Scotland to achieve our targets and see the interests of those who like to go to the hills, and the gamekeepers, whose work I very much support, continue to be carried out successfully and professionally.
I think both organisations will feel a little bit more confident that there's a balanced approach. Jamie, your next question.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning, Joe. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned the three areas, or the three key areas, on how to improve planting, increased budget, the approval process, and the delivery plan. And it seems to me that the three very much should work together in conjunction, and I welcome those ambitions as I do the targets. I think where my concern lies is around the first point, and that's the budget that's been allocated to it. And I wonder if we might sort of delve into that just a wee bit on those numbers and how we're going to achieve those targets. So, for example, the Cabinet Secretary mentioned Confor received quite a lot of evidence from them. And their analysis of the budget leads us to believe, in any case, that to achieve the 10 1,000 hectares per annum target would require a budget of around £45 million. 13,000 hectare target, £59 million, and there on up to the 15,000 target. Given that there was the £40 million in the 17-18 budget, I just wondered how the Cabinet Secretary will provide where the additional funds will come from in order to be able to hit the target, because it seems to me that the money seems to be hard cash, really is required to hit those targets.
Well, it's a very, very fair question. Let me answer it thus. You know, first of all, and I think in our previous outing as a sort of duo of witnesses being grilled on this committee, Joe pointed out that the problem in the past hasn't been lack of money or insufficient budget. The problem has been lack of availability of suitable applications. And it is a chicken and egg situation. I think that's recognised. What we have created, I think, over the past 9 months is a very, very clear sense in the industry that the Scottish Government is in full support of a moderate, balanced policy supporting more forestry according to good silvicultural practice. And that has really been taken up, and Joe will perhaps look out the figures, which I don't have, about the take-up rate and bring them in. But I want to just address the question about the figures, because this is important. And I don't think there is actually, incidentally, a perfect answer of any magic number here. I don't think it's like that. But, you know, we have to reflect the grant to the likely availability. You know, if we have 50% more grant than applications, that doesn't in itself achieve very much. But so we have increased the budget, £34 million, to reflect the forecast increased demand in grants. However, in addition to that, planting will be carried out by forest enterprise on the National Forest Estate. Now, that doesn't claim grant. So, in other words, some of the plantings, which will, of course, go towards meeting the target, are plantings that occur by the public sector without the requirement for grant. That's one factor. And to date, managing the estate has involved small, discrete purchases and disposals of appropriate land and forests, and that careful approach would continue. But we should also consider how to make best use of the resources realised from such sales. Under the last grant scheme, the average cost of woodland creation was £4,500. But this is the second substantive point I make to answer Mr. Green's question. We would expect the average cost per hectare to reduce as the average size of schemes increase and more productive schemes which receive lower rates of grant come forward. Economies of scale, that's the way these things go, and the way these things should go, actually. The latest Forestry Commission approval round saw 1,300 hectares of new planting, and that was approved at a cost of £3,846 per acre, per hectare, sorry. So that... well, that's why I have officials correct ministers. That's their job in... Well, to praise and correct ministers, that's the twin role. But you know, having said that, and also I'd allude to the Timber Transport Fund. I mean, plainly, you can't fell trees if you can't access the trees. If they're landlocked, and this is a particular problem in the Highlands, if they're landlocked, you can't actually fell them. And that then is worse than useless, because if then you get wind blow, and then it becomes impossible or very impracticable or much more expensive to extract the trees. So the Timber Transport Fund increase, although it's not colossal, but I think it has already been welcomed by the industry as playing a part in the overall task that we face. But I do want to ensure that we have as much available funding as possible into planting and to make the cost of planting as efficient as possible. And in the future spending reviews, I will obviously be arguing our corner there and end.
That's very, very helpful, actually, the understanding of knowing that the calculation was made on an estimate of £4,500 per hectare, that cost comes down, therefore the equation changes and you get more for your money. I appreciate it. I wonder if we may receive some further written submission, happy for it to be after the committee, on the 10,000 target and what your forecasts on that are in terms of which element of it will be grant funded planting and which element may be some of the public funding, which I was unaware of prior to today. I think that would be really helpful at some point.
I think there was one other point, which it's a bit of a technical point, but the grant that we pay is spread over a number of years. So the amount that you pay out in year one is only a proportion of the cost. So because we've had 2 years of low levels of planting, the total money that we need for next year, it isn't the full amount of the grant for the 10,000 hectares or 9,000 hectares or whatever we achieve. It's the first instalment. So in terms of budgeting, it's not a straight, you pay all the money up front in the year that it's claimed. So that's another factor to take into account.
I think that would be helpful, especially, I mean, I think the planting was last year was 4,500 hectares, which means that it would be less of the overall total. But Joe, if you're going to supply that to the committee, which would be very helpful, there is a very tight timescale by the end of next week. I don't know if you can comply with that.
I'll do what I can. Yeah.
I would appreciate that. Thank you.
And that's for next year how we've come to that balance between private sector and public sector planting.
Yeah.
Sure.
It would be helpful just to have a little note of, because the requests are now mounting. Maybe the clerks,
the clerks will definitely write to you, Cabinet Secretary, and let
just to help
you know.
Not take up too much of Joe's time.
Absolutely, we will write to you. The next question is from John.
Just a short one, Cabinet Secretary. The point was made to us by one of our witnesses that everything in the plan is to do with hectares and the area of ground that we're covering, but obviously the aim of all of this is CO2 emissions, and that other factors can come into that, like the location of the tree planting and the type of soil. I mean, are you comfortable that really these are relatively minor variations and we're right to focus on the hectares, and that actually the soil and things is not too important?
Okay, I think Joe probably has the better expertise to answer that.
To keep it as brief as possible.
Of course, I'll do what I can. We write it in terms of hectares because that's easiest for everybody to understand. Everybody can get their heads around an area. The calculation makes assumptions of an average type of forest for each of those hectares. That's then converted into carbon, equivalent tonnes of carbon dioxide removed each year, which is 7 tonnes per year per hectare of this average forest. That's how the calculation is done. Okay. Now, there are variations. The science, we don't have all the science yet in terms of what the carbon dynamics are on different soil types and different types of trees. We know there are differences, but I think we do need to remember we don't only plant trees for carbon. Plant trees for a whole range of different objectives, and there'll be a trade-off between what's best for carbon, what's best for other things, and that's what we're constantly doing. But that's why we use this average forest type approach.
Okay. Thank you very much for not going into yield classes and Hopper's measure, because Rhoda's got the next question.
Thank you. Sorry, I thought I was stubborn.
Ask the next question, but briefly, if I may.
Yes, indeed. We've seen that in the past our native hardwoods have not really been used very much. There has been a great deal of planting of native hardwoods under better conditions. What are we doing to involve that material in our construction process now that we've got better quality in the ground?
Sure.
A lot of the native trees that have been planted weren't planted for production. They were planted for other reasons, including carbon sequestration and biodiversity. Therefore, a lot of the native woodland resource that we have around Scotland, the quality of the timber for joinery or for construction is limited, but there are areas where we can grow really good quality hardwoods, but it's still quite niche, and hardwoods take longer to reach maturity. So all of the work that's gone on over the last 20 years, those trees are still only a quarter of the way through their life cycle, so they're not that ready to be harvested yet. However, there are other uses. I think the one thing that is really interesting, although it's a low-value end use, is local fuel wood use and the use of native woods as a resource for that. But to go back to the point about the quality hardwood sector, we work closely with the Association of Scottish Hardwood Sawmillers. We support them, which is pulling together these really talented and enthusiastic people who will take the resource that we've got and try and drive more value from it. Personally, I think there's potential for birch, but my whole career we've been trying to get something from this fabulous tree that, that just grows everywhere in Scotland and trying to get some better quality from it. Research continues into that. We haven't yet cracked it, but we are continuing to research on it. We work with the Association of Scottish Hardwood Millers, and that's something that we are continuing to do. It is quite niche, it is quite small, but it's definitely got a future. The other thing I would say is on the National Forest Estate, Forest Enterprise have had a significant programme. I don't have all the details, but I'm sure they could write and let you know, on establishing more hardwood trees specifically for timber production. And they've got a number of these cases that, that's growing into quite a programme across the National Forest Estate. But obviously those trees aren't going to be ready for harvesting for another 50, 60 years. So it'll be a while before you get the output from them. Key thing is you need to grow them quite close together and manage them carefully in the early stages if you want to get good quality timber.
Red, I regret that I'm going to have to cut you short there, because I have promised Mike the last question. And Mike.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And I wanted to combine my question to both agriculture and forestry. We all know that this is a draft climate change plan. Minister, you've had... You must be anticipating making changes already in the light of the responses that have come in through this whole process. And I was wondering if you could enlighten us if you are anticipating making changes to the plan. But almost as important is the next part of the question really is, what now? What's the process for finalising the plan? Where do we go from here?
Well, we have really only very recently published the draft plan, and therefore we do need to give full consideration to the replies. I myself have not had the opportunity to study them as yet. Secondly, obviously we work on a collegiate basis, and my colleague Rosanna Cunningham is in the lead on this, and therefore she will be the lead minister on this whole area of work, with my playing into that role. So I think it's really too early to commit to any changes, because were I to do so, I'd be kind of prejudicing the views of people whose views I haven't yet studied and haven't been considered.
So far that jumps out at you and say, oh, well, gosh, that... I'm not asking for a response, you know, a detailed response to these things. I'm just asking whether it's a reasonable... I would think it's a reasonable question. Is there anything that's jumped out at you which you thought, oh, well, that's a really good issue that we haven't perhaps examined in the draft plan?
I think the responses have been reasoned and useful, positive, and that's what I've expected. So I wouldn't use the phrase jumped out at me, but the dialogue this morning has been very encouraging. I think that's been the case. And the responses that my colleague Rosanna Cunningham has had, who has dealt with more public engagement on this matter than I have. I'm not primarily dealing with this in my portfolio, so the responses, the engagement I've had at various recent events haven't been primarily focused on that. We are very keen to hear from this committee and other key stakeholders to look at the responses and see if we can improve the draft plan. And I'm sure that we're entirely open-minded in how we go about that process. I mean, after all, plan is just the words on the page. That's what a plan is. It's what laws are. It's how it works in practice. And therefore, I'm particularly interested, I suppose, in criticisms, suggestions that members of this committee or the committee as a whole may have about how in practice we can actually be more likely to achieve the forestry targets, for example, more likely to persuade farmers to take up the use of soil testing. If there are positive suggestions, that's really what I'm interested in above most other things.
Okay, Cabinet Secretary, that actually is the end of the questions that we've got for you. I rudely did not give you a chance to make an opening statement. If you want to make a brief closing statement, we're very happy to hear that.
Well, I just would really like to make one point, which I'm not sure has been covered, but obviously the plan describes the contribution that forestry can make to delivering the Scottish Government's climate change commitment through increasing the creation of new woodland and the use of woods in construction. I don't think, with respect, we, perhaps in the limited time we had, we covered the use of wood in construction. And therefore, I wanted to underscore the point that this is extremely important. I mean, if we are going to grow more trees, and we've been harvesting a kind of record number of trees, the harvesting levels have been high. That's why the restocking issues, which haven't been touched on, have come into play as well. But I just wanted to emphasise just a single point, that we do want to see the increased use of Scottish wood products in construction. And we want to see it, and it's in our plan, increase from 2.2 million cubic metres to 3 million cubic metres by 2030. And how will we do that? Well, very much working with the whole sector, from the nursery through to looking after the forests as they grow, through to felling, but then, of course, the sawmill sector and excellent companies such as James Jones, BSW, Gordons in my own constituency, and many other sawmillers who are at the heart of rural communities. And they are really committed to Scotland. You know, they don't up sticks and leave. Well, they can they? But they don't want to. They're entirely committed to communities, and they need the supply of timber. And I think the point needs to be made that one of the reasons, the other reason than environmental, is that we do need to supply more timber. And already some of your witnesses have pointed out probably that there's a dip forecast in the beginning of the 30s, I think. And that kind of is not good. And it is so serious that it's impaired some financing decisions, I think, or had at least a role to play. And therefore, how do we achieve this? Well, we encourage the take-up of wood in house construction, for example. And I think that this is something that Scotland can and is taking a lead on, and perhaps looking to forage south and wean the English away from their love of the brick and look more towards timber as a sustainable material for construction for the rest of this century. Now, I know we haven't had time to go into that, but since you kindly invited me, I'm not someone that likes to spurn a useful invitation. Thank you.
Secretary, thank you. And thank you for mentioning all those firms which I know so well because they're in the region that I go and visit. I'd like to thank you and Joe O'Hara for the evidence that you've given this morning. It's been extremely useful. We will be writing to you, Cabinet Secretary, with a list of points that have been brought up. And I'd now like to briefly suspend the meeting for 5 minutes, committee members, before we move on to our next session. Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. I'd like to continue the evidence on the Scottish Government's draft climate change plan and welcome the Minister for Transport and Islands, Humza Yousaf, to the meeting. The Minister's joined by Donald Carmichael, Director of Transport Policy, and Jonathan Dennis, Economic Advisor at Transport Scotland. Minister, I'm very happy to allow you to make an opening statement, but in the spirit of that there are quite a lot of questions, I would ask you to keep it as brief as possible. Please, Minister.
I will do my best, and thank you for that, convener. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss the transport aspects of the climate change plan with you. I look forward to hearing what the committee has to say, some of their advice and some of their reflections as well. It goes without saying, convener, that the policies and proposals as set out in the climate change plan are challenging, and that is the intention, of course, continuing to place Scotland at the forefront of this agenda. Of course, in setting out such an ambition, we need to balance the needs to reduce emissions, primarily, of course, with the needs also of individuals and indeed the economy as a whole. And I believe that this plan balances these sometimes competing priorities. We envisage a Scotland in which the economy grows, but transport emissions decline very significantly over the next 2 decades. I'm sure we'll debate much of the detail, but I hope you will appreciate through that a very methodical and evidence-based approach has been taken to this transport chapter. If I just very briefly touch on some of the content of that transport chapter, convener, of course, the overarching target is to drive down transport emissions by 35% by 2032, a significant commitment. And the key strength of the chapter is the articulation of the real on-the-ground changes that need to happen in order to reach that very ambitious target. I won't go into, because of the brevity and the time, the detail behind that, the modelling behind that, the times model, the element energy model, but I'm sure members will want to ask and around some of that. There has been a bit of a focus, of course, by some on the fact that the plan in the chapter on transport is very, very technology heavy and technology driven. But for me, the reality is that technology is changing and changing fast, and simple arithmetic tells us that we gain more carbon abatement through greening our technology than by any other means, especially if we focus on the sectors that are perhaps easier to green, which would be cars and vans. In fact, even if we sat on our hands and did nothing, technology alone is projected to deliver half of the abatement asked for transport by 2032. There's no surprise that we focus on electric and other low emission vehicles. We need to work with the grain of such technology as opposed to trying to compete against it as well. Again, I'm conscious of time. I would say that doing what we've done in a value for money way is also very, very important. I don't think we should shy away from that fact, convener, as well. We're in times of financial constraint. We have competing and very demanding targets, competing priorities, and it's important that we get we can get as much out of the pound as possible. The second element, and I'll try to finish on this because of I understand there'll be a lot of questions, is on behavioural change. So technology heavy, a lot of effort on the technology is very important for us. Behaviour change is also important for us as well. So whether that's on active travel, which we take very seriously, but it's fair to say that active travel alone cannot deliver the carbon savings on a significant scale, although it can deliver other core benefits which we know of. But in terms of CO2 emissions, simply not enough road journeys of the right length and type to be capable to be diverted onto active travel. But behaviour change is examined through other options, and again, I'll discuss them, no doubt, with members through the transport chapter. Again, I don't think I will go into the detail that I've got here on the modelling, because I am conscious of your time, and in fact, I'll just leave it at that and just look to hear what the committee has to say, what members have to say. This is challenging, but it is intentionally so. It is meant to be challenging because of the nature of the difficulties that we all face as a planet, but indeed, of course, as a country as well. So I'll be happy to listen to reflections, take questions from members.
Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you for keeping it brief. Mari's got the first question.
Thank you, Convener. I really just wondered if you could give the committee an update on the implementation of the transport-related policies that were in the RPP1 and RPP2, and if you can tell us whether the emission reduction targets from transport that were in those documents have been met to date so far.
Yeah. In terms of RPP and RPP2, there was a lot of criticism that transport wasn't shifting its weight necessarily. And there was other sectors and others were doing a lot more. And I think that was fundamentally misunderstanding the nature of transport. There's not a quick fix or a quick win across government, but particularly true in transport because there is a need for technology to be able to be adopted. And so in terms of RPP and RPP2, we actually are where we want, where we expected to be. So we expected to be at 13 megatons, and that's where we are. So in terms of your specific question, are we where we expected to be? Yes. And that's partly predicated on the fact that if you take electric vehicles, an example, is a big target, of course, one of the main targets in our transport chapter, 40% of electric vehicle take up by 2032. The technology, as it advances, it goes through different phases. So you have the innovators phase, you know, those that are taking a chance on technology that is being tested and tried. You then go into the early adopters phase of technology, and then, of course, you eventually get into the majority, which where we want Scotland to be into the future. But we are very much at the innovators phase, and even in RPP and RPP2, it was recognised that the major reductions, or significant reductions, I should say, in transport emissions would come into the late 2020s. And that's still where we're at, even with this current plan at the moment. We're not saying that you'll see immediate reductions of a significant scale. We still expect to see them into the late 2020s, mid to late 2020s onwards.
So do you think that the complete decarbonisation of the surface transport by 2050 remains a realistic target?
Yes, yes. You know, again, we'll see how technology advances. And, you know, at the moment, there's so much talk of driverless cars and that technology and car ownership completely changing, the model of car ownership completely changing. Of course, the plan has to allow some sort of flexibility when you're looking that far ahead into the future as 2050. But the targets in the plan are realistic, and I stand by them. And the reason why I've got confidence in them is because of the modelling that underpins them. Again, which we can go into in a little bit more detail, perhaps, if other members want me to. But certainly, because of that methodical process that's been followed, I have confidence in the targets, yes.
Thank you.
Minister, thank you. You mentioned modelling, and we've got the best person here to talk about it. Stuart is going to give you a question on modelling, I think.
Stevenson.
Fortunately, in the 50 years since graduating, I've forgotten all my maths, so don't let's worry about it. But the plan does make an assumption of vehicle journeys rising by 27% by 2030. Where did that come from, and is that really necessary?
First of all, the most important part of my answer to that question would be that that's not a target, it's a forecast of where we're likely to be. And that's what the times and the element models do. They look at the demographics, patterns of households, individual needs in terms of their employment, so where will people go to work and travel back and forth. And the target that the member mentions is the expected demand growth if we sit on our hands and do nothing at all. The point is we've created a plan to try to tackle some of that. So it shouldn't be seen as a target, far from that. It's simply a forecast that the model uses. So the work that we're doing in the climate change plan, we would look to ensure that any road mileage, of course, is done in a way that fewer emissions there's fewer emissions involved in that. So I think the important point is, you know, we have, you know, balancing priorities in terms, and they can sometimes be competing priorities, and we should be honest about that when it comes to economic growth and other such things versus what we're trying to do in terms of carbon abatement. But I think what I would like to say on that, and that 27% target, it's not a target, that very point, and that it is a forecast based on the modelling.
So that's the figure that is before us. what figure do you think is going to be the outcome in 2030 then? Because you've said that's not the outcome you seek.
Again, at this stage, I wouldn't put a number on it because it does depend on some of the discussions that take place with, for example, local authorities on the low emission zones. As I said, that is forecast if we sit there doing nothing. It might be worth me passing to Jonathan, who's done a little bit more detail on some of the modelling and coming in on that. But my point remains that, and I know there was some criticism from ENGOs on this, who looked at that 27% figure and said, well, that's not good for the government to have that target. And I just want to reiterate, it's not a target, it is simply the forecast.
Yes, thank you, Minister. I mean, as has been, Mr. Stevens has asked here, if you look back, the predictions that we've got here in terms of if the population growth, economic growth, car ownership, et cetera, this is where we would end up. It's not a forecast. It's just if we do nothing more. If you look back historically, what you've seen over the last few years is lower growth, for a number of reasons. Obviously, we've had the economic recession, and the policies that are part of the RPP process are looking to move people into alternative modes. So it would certainly be less than that. But I think until we get to the point of actually understanding, you know, how these measures interact, how the technologies improve over the, and they have improved since we undertook RPP2, battery costs have come down faster than anticipated. So the rate of change and the rate at which people will change modes and will change vehicle types is still an unknown at the moment.
Just clarify something, just because I may have missed something that Stuart probably will pick up on, but... Minister, you said that the 27% wasn't a target, it was a forecast. Jonathan, you've just said that 27% wasn't a forecast, and then you went on to say something else. I'm confused. The 27%, is it a forecast of where you think we're going to be, or is it, having heard, it's not a target?
It's essentially what it is based on population growth, based on economic growth and the change in demography that we have in Scotland, and the existing set of policies that we've already announced in terms of the RPP process. This is where we think we will end up if we do nothing further. So it's based on the existing set of policies, where would we end up if we did nothing else?
It's a forecast of where we're going to be. Sorry, I'm unclear. You're not saying forecast. You're saying it could be where we're going to be.
If we do no more than the existing set of policies.
That's really
okay. Sorry, Stuart.
What we need to be clear what that means is the government and public policy. And the reason I'm focusing on this is it strikes me there are a whole series of things which are really not at our hand at all that are going to happen. For example, nothing I am wearing today was bought by my visiting a shop. Everything I'm wearing today was bought online. That wouldn't have been true 10 years ago. And that's pattern. People are buying their weekly shop and so on. How much of that, things that are changing, is actually... Go away, Michael. How much of that's changing, that is nothing to do with government policy, is incorporated in your view of the 27%? And how much of a contribution to it being less than the what you said, if we do nothing more, is 27%. Not sure who the we is.
Yeah, I get
and
your
we
point.
Know that there is going to be things happening. So I'm just not satisfied that this 27% is any sort of sound basis for looking forward to where we already, in the light of what we know and what's happening, we will actually get to in 2030. And I think it's very important the committee, in understanding the totality of the plan, get a sense of what you really think with what we kind of already know, and there are many unknowns between here and 2030, we will end up with. Because I just don't believe that 27%, to be blunt.
Okay. A couple of things to say. Well, first thing, I'm pretty pleased I didn't hear whatever the sedentary remark was, because I feel like I've been saved from something there. But in terms of the overall target, can I just remind the member that the 35% in reduction of emissions from transport is key to, and that is the key target that we're working towards in that transport chapter, and that's important not to lose sight of that. He is absolutely correct to insinuate and allude to the fact, I should say, that the targets of that 35% reduction, or indeed trying to, if we dampen that 27% growth in transport, growth will require a collaborative effort, not just between government, but we've been very clear in this climate change plan, including in the transport chapter, that is going to include collaboration with local authorities. So if we take low emission zones as an example, the private sector undoubtedly, again, as the member alludes to his own shopping patterns as well. So consolidation centres, for example, will require the private sector buy-in. What I couldn't do, although the element energy modelling is available online, and if the member wants to give a copy of that, I'm sure we can send that across to him. What I wouldn't do is say X percentage of that 27% absolutely relies on everything the government can do. Because frankly speaking, if we've explored, for example, or said we will explore workplace parking levies, and that will come down to whether or not, for example, local authorities want that enabling legislation. Now, if through deliberations and consideration with local authorities, they don't want that, and that isn't a route we end up going down, then clearly we would have to think about what else we can do in order to meet our carbon abatement. And therefore, for me to be able to say, well, 30% of it relies on government intervention, 30% relies on local authority intervention, and 30% plus is on the private sector, and the 10% relies on, you know, just people changing the behaviour, then, you know, that is going to have some level of flexibility depending on what works and what doesn't work.
We may come back to this.
Okay. Sorry, John.
A small supplementary on that, if I may. Minister, you made a comment about workplace parking levy. Table 7, which says cost-effective policy options for mitigating transport emission, with regard to workplace parking level, it says that the policies and proposals are no policies or proposals.
I'll look at the detail of what is said, but what we said about workplace parking levy, and there are some good examples of where it's potentially working, but it's at very, very early stages in Nottingham, for example. And for what we've said is that we would explore further with local authorities. We haven't made a commitment about, you know, this is what we would absolutely commit to, workplace parking levy in XYZ geography. Clearly, it's going to have to happen as a result of conversations with local authorities and other partners. So what we will do is have those conversations, and therefore, if legislation, enabling legislation is needed, then again, we can have that conversation. I have to say, it's not something that's come up in conversations yet that I've had with local partners, but that absolutely could change.
John, if I may, thank you. It's just, and I appreciate it's draft, and it may be that you're going to change that to say no policies, but the proposal is to consult. But that's something that's replicated through that entire table, where we have 7 cost-effective policy options for mitigating transport emissions, where beside it is the phrase no policy or proposals.
What I can do is certainly take the member's point about looking about how we redraft or perhaps reword that, because the point is so much, and it goes back to my previous point to Mr. Stevenson, that so much of what we want to try to do, or a significant part of what we want to do, will rely on conversations with other partners, be that private sector or in this case, local authorities, and therefore we have to wait for the outcome of those discussions. But the intention is to absolutely explore them in good faith, to see if we can bring them forward in order to meet our targets. But I take the member's general point. Perhaps they can be worded in a way that gives a little bit more confidence.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Question's going to be John.
Yeah, I mean, thanks. Following on, really, from the previous part, when we've been looking at the actual reductions and so on, I mean, transport, if we compare it with other sectors in the economy, is one of the major, if not the largest, a source of emissions, and yet we're talking about 31 or 32% a reduction being targeted. So, I mean, how do you argue that that is the right level compared to other sections, or are you even looking at it compared to other sectors?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, I think it's a really good question. The 35% figure that we've arrived to, including the sub-targets that we've arrived to in terms of the 40% of electric vehicles, or indeed the 50% of green buses, etc., etc. All of those targets are underpinned by a very methodical very evidence-based approach. And that relies on a number of models, primarily the ones that members know about, the times model plus the element energy model. And there has been, let's take one example, there has been some criticism that, for example, we haven't gone with the target, for example, the Climate Change Committee suggested in its advice to us. I think it was around about 60 or 65% of electric vehicles by 2030. And the reason for that is because what we've done, applying our models, and again, we can go into detail of that, but looking at the models, we have what is a realistic pathway. So when the member asks, you know, is this achievable? Is it ambitious enough? Yes, it's ambitious, but also it's credible and deliverable. And so, you know, the emissions that we are contributing to as a transport sector and that envelope, of course, feed into the wider cross-government effort, which will see us reduce emissions by 66% by 2032 across all emissions. So, yes, we're playing our part in a very, very significant target and one that will not be easy to achieve, but one that is credible and can be achieved.
Okay, and I mean within the transport, and I mean I should have probably declared I'm convener of the cross-party group on rail, so I am very enthusiastic about rail. I also am enthusiastic about ferries. And yet when it comes to government investment, I mean, these two sectors contribute very, very low emissions in comparison to road, be that cars or freight. You know, is that a factor when the government's deciding how much to invest on capital projects? You know, is electrification of the railway, I mean, I like the idea, but is it good value for money from this perspective, reducing emissions? Because we're putting quite a lot of money in, maybe not having, you know, a huge difference. Same with ferries, perhaps?
I think the it's a good point made by the member. What we're looking at, those modal shift. I mean, if we can make rail more attractive, then hopefully we can get people off there and out of their cars, where we know is the largest emissions are coming from, and onto the trains. So if, for example, taking his example of electrification, if we're able to have high-speed trains going between our cities, if we're able to have electrification that makes the journey shorter, quicker, easier, longer trains that we're investing in, then that makes the rail option a more attractive option. Now, of course, as well as speed of journey, affordability has to be a part of that. So, you know, we heavily subsidise, as the member knows, rail. And therefore making it affordable and trying to make it as affordable as possible will help that modal shift. So it's worth the investment for a number of reasons, but if we're looking at the climate change agenda so that we can hopefully attempt to shift people from their cars onto rail and freight as well. Freight is still a significant contributor in terms of emissions. If we can get freight from road onto rail, that will also help us to reach our target.
But if we look at it the other way around, then Perth and Inverness were investing a lot on the roads, but not very much on the railway. So that's going to switch people from the railway to the road?
No, I mean, at the moment, you could make the argument, which I think is a very valid one, that at peak times, if you saw the number of HGVs backed in a single carriageway, actually some of the argument has been that having a dual carriageway will help freight to move quicker, not be clogged up in single lane traffic at peak time with the engines running. So what we do has to balance up. I'm not suggesting that, of course, investing in road and dual carriageways won't have a potential impact in increasing emissions over the piece. We have to be aware of that, but we have to ensure that we're also balancing that off and offsetting that in other policies that we have. But we have competing priorities, that is true. There's no point trying to get away from that. What we have to do is manage those competing priorities in such a way that's deliverable, credible, in order to meet our carbon abatement targets, which I think are very ambitious.
Okay, thanks.
Ryder, you've got a brief supplementary.
Just a brief supplementary on air travel, given the reductions in APD. I mean, that seems to fly in the face of trying to cut carbon from transport, because that will increase carbon from transport.
You're right. I mean, again, there's no way of getting around the fact that, of course, a reduction in APD would increase the level of the number of flights, and therefore potentially, of course, increase emissions. So I won't even, you know, I think that's a correct argument. But what I would say is go back to what the Climate Change Committee have said, and I don't want to misquote, so I'll just use the correct quote. But it does say that the increase in emissions generated from an APD cut is, quote unquote, manageable if additional measures are taken to account for this increase. So generally it's seen that the paper estimates that a 50% cut, you know, kind of blanket cut across the board of APD would lead to a maximum emissions increase of around 0.06 megatons. That would be 0.1% of the total Scottish emissions. Therefore, this is likely to be manageable. That's the whole quote. So, the reduction of APD meets some very, very good ambitions of the government in terms of global connectivity, including increasing tourism to Scotland, et cetera, which has some great benefits for business, for the economy, and so on and so forth. But we have to, and the member's right, we have to ensure that we're offsetting that. And according to the Committee on Climate Change, that is manageable.
Minister, I'm going to stop you there on that one. I noticed there are other members around the table, specifically John Finney, would like to come in, but I'm afraid we're very pushed for time. And I would ask if you could keep the answers as short as possible when we move on to the next question, which is on low-emission vehicles from Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. In the interest of time, what I'll do with this section, it is quite a meaty section, and I hope other members will be inspired to perhaps come in, but I'm very happy for some of these questions to be answered in writing after the meeting, if it's easier for you or if it gives you more time to research the responses. So I'd like to split it into two parts. The first part is some very specific questions, which again, perhaps your officials can take away. And then the second part is more on policy. So I think you mentioned in your opening statement up front that the plan is very technology heavy, but you did mention behavioural change as being a big part of that. I think given that it is technology heavy, it's important we look at your own ideas on that. On ultra-low emission vehicles, can I ask the first specific question on what conversations you've had with the UK government on vehicle excise duty, the changes which are coming in April, if you think that fits in with your overall plan in Scotland. The second specific point is what funding is going to be available for charging points after August 2019, as we know that's when the current funding plans end. So I'm happy to sort of park those aside, maybe you can come back to them later. But I think as an overall point, what do you think the Scottish...
I'm just going to interrupt. I mean, if we could have a brief answer on the charging points and the discussions, I think it'd be useful.
Yes, well, just a very brief one would be that, yes, we share the concerns that many have in the NGO sector about the changes in vehicle excise duty. I understand the kind of logic of why the UK government thinks that it might be a good idea and incentivises, you know, electric vehicles, but ultra-low emission vehicles then are the ones that are going to suffer from that. So I can get the member a greater response in a little bit more detail about what we've done and what my officials and conversations my officials have had with the DfD on some of that. In terms of the funding, I would simply say that we've committed to the funding, as he says and rightly says, to 2019. The RPP and RPP2 told us that we have to invest heavily in the infrastructure. We've done that. We have 600 charging points, 1,200 charging bays, rapid charging points across Scotland. We'll continue to invest in that. And of course, we have a fund scheme for those who want to put a large electric charging points at their domestic residence. Now, we can review that come 2019 and the progress that we've made on that. But the infrastructure is making great progress and continues to make great progress. It may be that we have to rebalance from the infrastructure, though we obviously have to continue to invest in that, to incentivising the vehicles even more than we are at the moment. So we would take a call on that closer to the time.
Okay. I think that leads nicely into the next point, is that given that your estimates are that, or you're working on the formula that 40% of vehicles by 2032 will be electric, I think that the answer that the funding will stop in 2019 is one that makes me slightly nervous. I would be hoping that maybe you might give some more commitment to that strategy if the take-up is going to be at those levels in the future. In terms of getting people onto ULEVs, what do you think the Scottish Government can do to incentivise or indeed subsidise take-up of those types of vehicles? Have you had any thoughts or discussions amongst officials about that?
First of all, I'd just like to clarify that I said we would take a call on funding in 2019 when we get closer to the time. I'm not suggesting that absolutely funding, that will be the cliff edge at all, but understand that the plans as laid out in the transport chapter are as we see them now, but we should have the flexibility to review them if uptake or, for example, if infrastructure needs to be updated and incentivised. In terms of the uptake of electric vehicles, again, we are broadly where we thought we would be, this innovator stage. I spoke about the innovators, the early adopters, the majority. So we are broadly where we thought we'd be in the uptake of electric vehicles. 2.5% of registration of new vehicles are electric vehicles. I should say that's 108% increase in the previous year. So it's going in the right trajectory, although starting from a relatively low baseline. So we're making good progress. In terms of the funding that exists, there's quite a lot of funding that has gone into this. There's £15 million into the Charge Place Scotland network, which he knows about. £3.5 million that's been spent on the fleet of 350 public sector vehicles. He knows probably about the Green Bus Fund as well, £15 million in terms of that. And then, of course, there's the Low Carbon Transport Loan Scheme, £10 million so far, which gives a loan to individuals, but importantly also businesses that want to transition from petrol and diesel cars to electric vehicles. So these funding schemes have been really well taken up, really well received, and the government is continuing with them. But it's fair to say that we have to examine as time goes on if the uptake is among the trajectory we expect it to be, and if we need to do something to further incentivize that. And I would go back to saying that we predicted in RPP and RPP2 the trajectory of the increased take-up would be in around the mid to late 2020s, and that's still the trajectory that we see.
It's a bit of chicken and egg there, I guess, in the sense that uptake may be higher if there are better incentives, including financial incentives, such as we took some evidence on some of the schemes they have in Norway, for example, on purchasing. I was really surprised and pleasantly surprised by the take-up of electric or hybrid vehicles in Norway based on some of the subsidies and incentives the government can offer. So it seemed like an interesting model we could look at.
Just very briefly on that point, if I can, for the member, because he's absolutely right to say that the Norwegian model, there's a lot of incentives, but there is also a little bit of the stick with Norway, and they have tax powers to be able to do that. So, I'm looking at the Norway model myself, and there's a little bit in terms of VAT on the vehicles that align the internal combustion engine are 25%, so there's a little bit of the stick as well as the carrot.
Thank you. The next question, Minister, is from Gail.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. We heard from Stop Climate Chaos Scotland and Friends of the Earth Scotland that there have been no demand measures given any serious consideration in the climate change plan, and you've already discussed things like workplace parking levies with John Finney. Can you explain why this is the case, that we're not looking at things like increased public parking charges or reductions in speed limits, what the Scottish Government is doing to actually manage demand?
I think the point is that we have an overall reductions commitment of emissions at 66%, and transport will play a part in that by reducing emissions by 35%. How we get there, of course, is important. I'm not taking away from that. But what we've managed to find is a model and a pathway, I should say, that does that in such a way that respects people's individual needs, the economy, but also our very, very important targets, our very, very important ambition to reduce carbon emissions. And we've managed to do that in a way that we think is the sensible and correct balance. That doesn't stop a local authority, for example, for if they choose to increase parking charges, if they want to do that. I don't think local authorities particularly are looking to go down that route, because there are other ways of meeting their emissions targets. And some of those we've discussed, and low emission zones are an example of that. So low emission zones, where you effectively stop a particular type of vehicle, emissions heavy vehicle, from coming into a particular location, be that a city centre or perhaps even, as we've discussed in the transport plan, a wider low emission zone in an urban area. then you are constraining demand. So you do constrain demand through things like low emission zones. We're not considering car parking charges. We're not considering those measures, and we're still achieving that, or we're confident of achieving that 35% reduction without those measures. So I don't see any need to do that.
You mentioned low emission zones. Have you got any plans to encourage local authorities to do pilot schemes?
I think the discussions that we're having at the moment on low emission zones at the moment going very well with the four largest cities in Scotland, and I think there's the largest cities would be the right place to start a low emission zone, and we said we'd have one up and running by 2018. That was in our manifesto. That's a very ambitious target, but one that we're working towards. The member may know that there's been various contributions from, as we go into the run-up of the local election, a number of political parties saying that they also would support a low emission zone. So generally I feel across the political spectrum there's some political will around a low emission zone. So I certainly think we'll see one by that 2018 target is what we're working, of course, towards. I'm very hopeful of that.
Okay, thank you.
Rhoda, do you have a brief supplementary?
About concessionary bus travel, given that any increase in the age limit for this would force people back into their cars, I think one of the unintended consequences of the concessionary travel was a lot of people reaching their 60th birthday moved on into rail travel, to bus travel, which was played its part in dealing with emissions. If that age limit is increased, will that impact on our emissions, forcing people back in their cars?
A couple of things I would say. First, we're at the pre-engagement stage, as the member knows, and I wouldn't want to preempt any consultation that will take place and what the result of that consultation would be, looking at a range of factors of how we make that scheme more accessible, but what I would say, more sustainable. What I would say to the member is we've also given a commitment to extend the scheme to modern apprentices and also for young people in our jobs grant. So you could also have the flip argument of that, which is, you know, getting young modern apprentices or even potentially those in a jobs grant instead of taking taxis, or for those that maybe are being driven around by parents or indeed driving themselves, then getting them onto the buses would be a positive. But she's right in the sense that we should take into account as part of the consultation discussion any unintended consequences. From my own, just anecdotally speaking, from those that are age 60 to pensional age, for example, and I'm not saying this is a route we're going down, but if that, since her question alluded to that, I'm not sure there's many 60 to 65-year-olds that just give up their car because they get the bus pass, but that is from my experience, and not to say that that is the case. So I will look, certainly as part of the discussions and deliberations we have in terms of the consultation on the concessionary travel scheme, that is something she's right to highlight and something that we should look at.
Would you do an assessment of that before you change this scheme?
Any changes to the scheme will be based on the consultation, but it has to go through various impact assessments, including indeed we should give a commitment that I'll absolutely look at any of the unintended consequences for our climate change plan, but I suspect it would be very, very small if it was negative at all. But I think, yes, she's right, we should absolutely be looking at that element.
Okay, the next question is from Mike, and I'll bring you in.
Buses, I'm a bit alarmed, I have to say, that you seem to be under the impression, in response to Rhoda's question, that to be successful, people have got to give up their cars rather than just using buses as more often than they would ever do before with this scheme. So I think it's a very good scheme. Minister, there are 1.3 million bus card holders. Passenger journeys have risen by less than expected in the last 2 years. Should we be aiming for 50% of the bus fleet to be electric by 2030 rather than simply low emission as is in the draft plan? Because if we do that and get more people to move from the car, it's not abandoning the car, but more move from the car to more bus use, that will decrease, I hesitate to say it, the forecast of 27% increase in car travel. This would be a really effective way of reducing that forecast of 27%, mm-hmm. getting people to use electric buses, and it's a win-win situation for everybody, for the environment,
and for health and for active travel as well, you know, by getting people out of their car. Mm.
Can I first clarify? I mean, I don't think I said, and I certainly didn't mean to suggest at all, that people going from car to bus, that it's an issue around success around that at all. I just simply made the point about behaviour patterns and behaviour changes just from my anecdotal evidence, but also agreeing with the member previously that, you know, we should be looking at any unintended consequences on emissions in terms of...
Could I just ask about that? Because I got the impression from your response, and I'm glad if it's not the case, but I got the impression from your response to Rhoda was that the success of this card scheme was, like you said, not many people have given up their cars, but that's not the point of the card scheme.
No, not the point. It wasn't being suggested, or certainly wasn't meaning to be suggested, so I'm happy to clarify that. In terms of the member's wider point, again, the point of having this discussion around the table, of course, is to take members' ideas, and we should reflect on what the member says in terms of electric buses, and it should be said that the element model in particular did have a degree of stakeholder engagement. So the bus operators were part of the conversation, so when it came to the bus chapter. So this, what we've come up with, is in consultation with the bus sector and what they think is achievable. And I have to say, I've been incredibly impressed recently. I've been to Lothian Buses, Stagecoach and First, and all three bus companies have got really ambitious plans for low-emission buses, transitioning or fast-forwarding that to electric vehicles, which are available, and I've been on an electric bus myself in Orkney as part of the when I was there visiting recently. It's something that we'd have to take back to the bus sector to see if they're comfortable with that pace of change. What I would say to the member, just the final point on this, from my perspective, that he's absolutely correct in saying that bus patronage, of course, has been declining for decades, and we need to find a way of reversing that, and that's a real challenge. Yes, the bus passengers' experience is really, really important on that. Tackling things like congestion is really, really important, and that's not just an urban issue, but so is, you know, making fares more accessible, smart ticketing. So there's a lot of challenges around reversing the decline in patronage, but the member's absolutely right. If we tackle that and we succeed in that, then it's a win-win.
Mike, before you say anything else, I think, John, you were trying to catch my eye on buses. Did you want to come in on
that? If I may, and it's on that very point. Now, yes. Minister, thanks for that information. It may be that I'm not very technical, I'm maybe a bit confused about it, but the plan at page 70 states a switch to bus users, in the quote, likely to be limited by capacity of the sector to absorb significant new traffic. Now, you've said very commendable things about the fleet and that, and I'm quite sure if we had the bus operators in here and asked them if your target was to double their patronage by 2032, I think they would all eat their arm off for that. So why are the government turning away from even considering an increase in bus patronage?
Again, I'll look at the drafting and I'll take that back that the member suggested. But no, I mean, I want to see an increase in bus patronage. I think transport ministers for decades have wanted that. The reality is that it's not an easy issue to tackle. We should, and it's not one that necessarily overnight can be reversed, but we are committed as a government through the bus stakeholder group, and I just had a meeting with them yesterday, in fact, on how we look to reverse some of that decline in bus patronage. But it will take more than one measure to do that. So we have the transport bill coming forward, of which there will be a bus element. That will be part of it. Discussions with local authorities will be a part of that as well. Tackling congestion and looking at the roadworks issue will be a part of it. So there's a number of things. And so I will go back and reflect on the wording as the member suggests. But certainly my ambition is to start to put in place what we need to put in place in order to see a reversal in that decline of bus patronage, which won't happen overnight or necessarily in 12 months, but it's something that we should be aiming for in the long term. Thank you.
Sorry, John, could I just ask you, you wanted to ask also about cycling. Could I ask you just to push, but very brief
Yes, indeed. Well, Minister, the transport emission reduction set out in the draft climate change plan are based on cycling having a 10% share of everyday trips by 2020. Cycling accounts for less than 2% of trips today. What's the Scottish Government going to do to move that target? And if I may, can I say that the Times modelling assumes that funding for active travel is to be frozen at 2016-17 cash values until 2021. So how does a real terms reduction funding of active travel equate to policy that supports more active travel? Mm-hmm. Again, page 71 for
your reference. Yeah, sure. Look, I would go back to just putting some context around some of those figures and some of those numbers, if I may. Active travel is at record levels, at 39.2 per annum, plus the fact that we've spent, well, that equates, in fact, to 175 million on active travel since 2011. That's far and above what previous governments have spent. I accept his point that he and other stakeholders will be pushing us to do more. But I would make the point also that in a time when we've had our budget cut, to be able to at least provide that certainty of funding at record level investment provides some element of comfort to our partners. Again,
it's about the relative percentage as well.
Say that again. Yes, and I'll come to that point. There's some in the sector who push us, for example, and I think it's a policy of his political party, that 10% of the transport budget should be on active travel. And I would just say simply, for me, that's not a realistic prospect, because you know, our budgets are committed to various contractual obligations that we have, dueling A9, A96, rail franchises, and so on and so forth. Now, of course, the member, if he was in my position, would say, you know, there may be projects that he would tell us not to push ahead with, but that is not the view of this government. What I would say to give him some, try to give him some kind of comfort, if I may, I recently chaired the Active Travel Task Force. For me, there still seems to be too many barriers, particularly at a local level, if I may say that, to cycling infrastructure. And I'm a believer and a big believer in segregated cycle paths and the importance that they have in terms of increasing cycling, giving confidence to cycle and to road users alike. And I've been disappointed in some of the decisions that have been made recently. So therefore, the Active Travel Task Force brings together local partners as well as the government and others to look to see how we can tackle some of those local barriers that exist. And that's what we hope to do. In terms of the climate change plan, there's a final point I'll make on this, on the transport chapter. The reason why we've been criticised by some in the cycling lobby and active travel lobby for perhaps not having too enough of an emphasis, I would just say that because the transport chapter is so focused on carbon abatement, understandably so, that because of the length of journeys where emissions are the highest, that it, you know, although cycling will have many benefits, health benefits, and so on and so forth, in terms of carbon abatement, it would have been very, very small in terms of the active travel piece. So that's why perhaps it doesn't have as much. That's not to say that we don't find it important or we don't support it enthusiastically. I do, but it's just, you know, there's a big focus on carbon abatement in this transport chapter.
Minister, I'm going to have to stop you there anyway. It was a logical break, but your answers are drifting slightly on the long side, and we have a few more questions. So okay, I could urge everyone to brevity, and the next question is from Richard.
Yes, good afternoon, Minister. Basically, you covered it yourself. You said on the roads, bigger and bigger lorries sitting behind a lorry. How do we get these loads off the road? We really need to switch to rail, try and get them onto rail. I live next to the Glasgow main line, Edinburgh main line, and watch freight trains going by occasionally when I was out, used to be out walking the dog. So what are you doing to support the development of infrastructure to allow longer freight trains to participate in order to take all these loads off the road?
Yeah, again, to try to be brief on that, we do have the mode shift revenue support grant, so 2.5 million tonnes have been moved from road onto rail, 100,000 HGV journeys removed from the car, and £7 million of environmental benefits have been realised from that. So there are funds that exist. There are funds also that exist for the same purpose that haven't quite been utilised to the extent that I would have liked them to be. So there must be an issue around that. So I've, you know, tasked officials to look at facilities freight grant and other such things in order to see how we can improve them.
Right, also the other, and I have to identify that there's actually an application in my area for this, which I'm going to ask you about. We've basically heard the evidence that despite a key plank in freight transport...
We try and keep it on a Scotland-wide basis.
Right, OK, well. Key plank freight transport emission reduction policy is a Scotland thing. Development of freight transport and rail centres has been opposed by quite a number of sectors, So what's the Scottish Government doing to encourage their development and use to reduce transport emissions?
Is that on consolidation centres?
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, it's mentioned in the transport chapter that it's something that we would be exploring. He is right to say there's resistance, and a lot of that resistance comes in from the private sector operators, and so the conversations will continue. All I can do is give him a commitment that we'll explore the data, because consolidation centres are used, including across the UK. I think it's important that we examine the evidence base for them to see whether or not actually they would have the impact we would want them to have, and therefore put the investment in. So all I can do is give them a commitment that it is something we're exploring.
To explain the reason why I said that was because, in case someone come back and said I hadn't identified that that was happening in my area.
Okay, thank you very much, Richard. I have the next question, Minister, and which is just really a question of, as far as planning goes, and we've been told and it's identified that it's a problem trip length between houses and places of work. Mm. And I wondered how the government was working with local government to try and make best use of land in development to ensure that trip lengths were kept as brief as possible.
Yes, a couple of answers to that, and just to keep them brief if I can, that working with local government is essential and across the transport chapter and what we do in collaboration with them. The local elections coming up, regardless of what the results are across the country, will give us a renewed impetus to do that. I mean, either if it's new regimes that come in or indeed the current regimes that are there, there generally is a renewed focus, I think. So that gives us an opportunity. Second thing I would say is that I'm working very closely with my colleague Kevin Stewart, who's leading the planning review. He and I have regular discussions around a number of issues, and I think this is one that we should certainly be able, officials are having a conversation on, but certainly I should be having a conversation with Kevin on, and we can see how we can flake that perhaps in the plan if appropriate.
Okay, thank you, Minister. The next question is, I think, Richard again.
Yes, in line with what the convener said to me earlier, I'll make it Scotland-wide. Build it. It's often said, build it and they will come. How do you reconcile the Scottish Government's transport emission reduction ambitions with the roads-focused capital investment that you've carried out, and basically you're talking about quite a number of roads throughout Scotland are being upgraded or improved, etc.?
Okay. I think I maybe touched upon the answer to that in previous answers, that we have to balance the priorities that we have in terms of economic growth, as well as what we're trying to do on carbon abatement. And so what we've done is taken account of the drilling of the A9, the drilling of the A96, other road projects that he knows about and going through his constituency, for example. He knows about those, but what we've done is taken those into account and yet got to deliverable pathway that reduces emissions by 35% by 2032.
Yes, well, you've now opened the Raith Interchange underpass under the M74, which has now stopped the car parking on a certain road, which I have to agree with you. Thank you very much.
I'm glad you got that in, Richard. Jamie, did you have a supplementary?
Can I bring in Mr. Carmichael? Can I ask him how much involvement you have in influencing or discussing with the Minister on transport policy, strategy and subsequent investment?
Well, it's the core part of my job.
And did you feed into the Infrastructure Investment Plan 2015 that we've looked at in this committee?
Not directly.
Okay.
It's not my lead role.
So the reason I ask is, in the last evidence session we had, and this is specific to the climate change plan and how the transport policy feeds into it, and I can open it up to anyone that's interested in answering. We asked each of the witnesses a very specific question, and that's whether the capital investment plans and policies of the Scottish Government supported the emission reduction ambitions of the government, and the answer was a resounding no from the witnesses. I just wondered if you had any comments on that.
Well, I think the Minister has just answered the question in that what we're discussing today is a plan which is built on current policies, including current investment decisions that ministers have taken.
Yeah, and just to add to that, I wonder, has the member seen the element, the energy modelling?
Pardon me?
Has the member seen the energy element, the element energy modelling?
No, I'll have to look at it.
Well, we definitely will, we'll send that across to you because I think it makes good reading because it does take into account the realities on the ground of how to achieve what we're trying to achieve. So, you know, you've got to balance up priorities in government and there's no shying away from certain actions that Rhoda Grant had mentioned about the APD cut that might well increase emissions in aviation, balancing that off with what we do in terms of carbon abatement. And I think we've managed to get something that's deliverable and I think that's a really key point.
I totally appreciate it. I think the problem is here is a perception, perhaps, that the strategy and the investment, capital investment in transport, isn't going to help you meet the emission reduction targets of the government. I think that's something that we found came across very strongly from all witnesses.
Thank you.
Okay, Jamie, I'm happy to leave it there. Minister, before we move on to the next agenda item, would you like to make a very brief closing statement, or are you happy that you've addressed the items that...
Yes, I mean, the only thing I would say is that I would like to thank members for it. There's a few things that I think we should certainly take back and reflect on and see how we can perhaps better word. And the offer is always an open one. If members want to talk on a one-to-one about any particular issues that they haven't had the time to do so, then my door is certainly open and we have a window of a few weeks to have that conversation in relation to the climate change plan. But no, I thank members for what I thought were eminently sensible suggestions.
Okay, thank you, Minister. I'd like to briefly suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to change. Could I ask the committee members to stay seated so we can move on to the next session as quickly as possible? Ladies and gentlemen, Donald's still to go. He's day. Okay. The agenda item 3 on our agenda is the taking evidence on the National Bus Travel Concession Scheme for older and disabled persons. The Minister is joined, Minister and Mr. Carmichael are joined by Tom Davey, the head of the Bus and Local Transport Policy Unit at Transport Scotland. The instrument's laid under an affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before the provisions can come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider the motion to approve the instrument. Can I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to discuss the draft National Bus Travel Concessionary Scheme for Older and Disabled Persons Scotland Amendment Order 2017. The order sets the reimbursement rate and cap level of funding for the National Concessionary Travel Scheme in 2017-18. In doing so, it gives effect to an agreement that we reached in January with the Confederation of Passenger Transport, which represents the Scottish bus industry. The agreement was based on a reimbursement economic model that was developed in 2013 on the basis of independent research commissioned at that time by the Scottish Government. The research was discussed extensively at that time with the CPT and its advisers. The model and recent discussions on updating the various inputs to it, including forecasts based on national trends and agreed indices, have given us a good basis for informed decisions to provide stability and clarity for all partners. Using the updated model on the basis of agreed forecasts, we've concluded that the appropriate rate of reimbursement in 2017-18 should be 56.9% of the adult single fare. We believe that this rate will most closely deliver the aim which is set out in the legislation and established the scheme, that bus operators should be no better or no worse off as a result of participating in this scheme. As this is the same rate as last year, it also provides welcome stability and continuity for the bus industry. On the basis of that reimbursement, of this reimbursement rate, and our expectations for future changes in journey numbers and fares, we forecast that the claims for reimbursement of bus operators be capped at 196.16 million over the next year. The figure is reflected in the draft order as the budgetary cap. The order is limited to the coming year. We've agreed with CPT that the reimbursement model will be reviewed during this year to ensure that it continues to provide a fair deal for all parties and it remains an appropriate mechanism for determining future payments. The committee will also be aware that we will be consulting in the coming months on ways in which to ensure the longer-term sustainability of the National Concessionary Travel Scheme and on the implementation of our commitment to extend free bus travel to young modern apprentices and young people on a jobs grant. We know that older disabled people greatly value the free bus travel that the scheme provides, which enables them to access local services, visit friends and relatives and gain health benefits of a more active lifestyle. The order provides for those benefits to continue for a further year on a basis that is fair to operators and that is affordable to taxpayers. I commend the order to the committee and, of course, happy to now take any questions on the scheme.
Thank you, Minister. Can I just remind the committee that this is on the provision that's in front of us, not any future provisions. John is first.
Thank you. Minister, I'm going to ask a question about the business and regulatory impact assessment. And it's important I tell you the source, because in the previous set of questionings, I alluded to the plan when I talked about a table. Actually, it was from the SPIFE briefing, so I apologise. It wasn't my intention to confuse in that. But it's simply a question about the rationale for government intervention. And just for the purposes of the records, if I read the first sentence, it says, the National Bus Concessionary Travel Scheme for older or disabled persons provides an entitlement to free bus travel for people over 60 or meeting certain disability criteria. The second sentence then says, this is believed to deliver social and health benefits by enabling people more easily to access services and visit friends and relatives. We're a number of years into the scheme. I would have thought evidence had been garnered entirely around the social and health benefits that this would bring.
Well, I've alluded to it in my opening remarks as well, that we believe there to be those social and health benefits. If the member won't mind, I'll maybe write to him with detail on whether, you know, what evidence we have for that. But it is generally believed, and I think it's right, that there's many, many benefits to the scheme. Otherwise, we wouldn't continue to pursue with it. We do recognise the benefits. Members will know that from their own constituents that they speak to on a regular basis. But in terms of the evidential base, if the member doesn't mind, perhaps it would be more suitable for me to write to him with some more detail on that.
Minister, could I write to the committee? Suggest that you write to the committee and we will ensure that it's passed on to the member, just for protocol.
Thank you.
Is it on that particular point? Because I've got a whole heap of people queuing up.
If I may, I mean, it says in the policy note, this has been shown to deliver social and health benefits. And I was going to ask about why there was a difference between the two. John Finney's picked up the other one. So maybe we could just cover that in the letter.
In the letter, yeah, sure. Yeah, I'll be happy to do that.
Okay, thank you, Stuart.
Thank you very much, Convener. The rate is staying at 56.9%, and that's 56.9% of the standard single fare. I just wondered, and there may be commercial sensitivities around this, so I phrase my question as, are officials and you aware, rather than inviting you to share information which we may not properly have, to what extent the standard single fare has, since the introduction of the scheme, diverged from the overall basis of fares? Because there's always been a little underlying worry that there's a little bit of gaming goes on, in that there's not much incentive to reduce the standard single fare, which beyond the bus pass scheme is probably little used. And I just wonder if you're confident that this fare isn't diverging from the fares that are otherwise charged to people who are paying money when they turn up for a bus.
I think it's a very good point, and one that it's fair to say we're very aware of. And within the first few months of this job, I was approached by a current MSP who used to be involved in the bus industry to suggest that I look at that as well. So to say we're aware of it, yes. What I would say to the member is, of course, this the reimbursement rate that we come to is, of course, a negotiated position, mm-hmm. which involves compromise on both sides, mm-hmm. from the government on behalf of the Scottish taxpayer, and indeed the bus operator as a private company. But certainly aware of what the member says. I don't think there's any games being played in terms of the adult single fare, but it's fair to say that we're aware of and alive to the possibility that
it could be happening.
It would be fair, Minister, to say that yes, the rates negotiate, but the fares are unilaterally set.
Sure.
Albeit notified to the Commissioner.
Sure. So I've no more. Thank you.
I think Tom wanted. Okay.
I don't know if it would help, but there is a test applied to fare tables when they're submitted by operators. We do look at the fares to see whether they. Getting feedback here, but we do look at the fares to see whether they are commercial, genuine commercial fares, the sort of fares that people are actually paying and so on. So that doesn't catch fares that may be sort of creeping up under less competitive pressure, but it does catch serious cases of gaming, or it would catch serious cases of gaming. We're due to review the reimbursement model over the course of the coming year anyway, and this question of whether the way in which we deal with the relationship between adult single fares and the fares that people would actually have paid if there wasn't a scheme, we're due to look at whether that the figures we use for that hold good.
Okay, just remind everyone gently, if I can say, that we're looking at the scheme for that's coming right down the line rather than the future. Mike, you were next.
Yeah, thank you. I just had to clarify some of the evidence that you gave this morning and the evidence provided in the policy note which you've given to us. In paragraph 7 of the policy note, in the third sentence, it says, bus fares and concessionary passenger journey numbers have risen by less than expected in the last 2 years since the cap was set. And in the evidence this morning, you, to answer my question, you said that bus journeys were going down. So what I'd like to know is, what is it? What is the facts here? Are bus journeys rising but to a less extent than you thought, or are they falling?
No, I think there's, and I'll ask Tom to come in slightly on this, but first of all, overall patronage on buses is declining. What we're simply saying is on the cap, which is the figure that we arrived to in negotiation with CPT, which we don't expect, we certainly won't pay out any more in terms of the scheme, is based on what we think the forecast number of journeys will be.
Right.
And the forecast number of journeys and the actual number of journeys that have come in over the years, not all of the years, of course, but over the years, if I look at the last 10-year figures, generally they've come in at a lower than what the budget cap is, which
okay,
is, of
no,
course,
I,
a good
I
thing.
Understand that, but my question is focused on the policy note which you provided, and I read it again. It says, bus fares and this is what we're looking at, the concessionary passenger journey numbers have risen by less than expected, which means that they have risen. Is that the case?
Do you want to comment on
it? It is the case that fares have risen by less than expected, and looking at the passenger numbers, we expected passenger numbers to rise. They have not risen. They rose by less. In fact, they fell. You're right to say that. I apologise if that sort of causes confusion. But
right, so I just want to get to the facts.
We are anticipating a rise. We've had a flat to a small fall. We are modelling on basis of a rise into next year. That's the basis of the budget cap.
Right, so I understand you.
Right. Yeah.
The concessionary, this is what we're focusing on, the concessionary passenger journey numbers have flatlined. Is that what you're saying?
Flatlined or gone slightly down. We anticipated slight increases.
But are you anticipating a slight increase?
We're anticipating into next year a slight increase, and this is on the basis of economic modelling done by CPT.
My next question then follows. You've cut in this order the level of cap by £16 million.
Yep.
Going back to our discussion with the Minister just now on trying to cut emissions, my question there was based on encouraging concessionary bus use and concessionary bus use in particular. It would strike me, rather than the answer that was given to me this morning, that yes, this would be a good thing, we would encourage it, what you're actually doing in the actual policy note is A, not anticipating that rise, as you've just said, you're reducing it, and you're cutting the cap figure. So if there was a reality to the policy that the government is pursuing, I'm not commenting on the policy, but I'm just saying the reality to it, if you would expect that if the reality of the evidence that we got this morning was that this is to be encouraged, then why are you reducing the cap?
Can I just make a point, and I'll pass over to Tom, that remember the cap is the ceiling of payments that you look to pay. The actual payment, the scheme payments, if I look from 2006 or 2007 to the current year, so if I take the 10 years, the current cap, the 196 million, is higher than what we've had to pay out every single year in the last 10 years, minus 1 year the 2012-2013. Mm-hmm. So it still, you know, has that leeway to allow an increase, even compared to last year's, which was the actual payments were 189.
But your figures here, 192 million in paragraph 7 again, the actual claim, reimbursement claim, is 192 million, and your cap is 196 million. So your cap is only 4 million more than what they paid out last year. So actually what you're, I'm going back to my point, and I'd like you to focus on this, is when you said that you wanted to encourage this, but the, but your policy is only increasing it by a maximum. Yes, but a maximum of 4 million from 192 million. Now, that, if we're looking at emission cuts, that's not very much, is it?
No, it's an increase. I mean, that is the point. And not only is it an increase, we're looking, as you know, this scheme that we're focusing on, the long-term sustainability of it. And now, if the cap had been lower than the payments, I would understand his point. But it is an increase.
You don't understand my point.
No, I do, and it's saying it's an increase. The cap is, you know...
I know it's an increase. The point I'm making is that it's a tiny increase when you are saying that you want to increase this use dramatically to change emission targets.
What we're saying is the bus element of the transport chapter, and I know okay. we're talking about the previous discussion, was about reversing bus patronage, not just the National Concessionary Travel Scheme, although that's an important part of it, but reversing the decline in bus patronage across the board. And there'll be a number of measures, not just the National Concessionary Travel Scheme, a number of measures tackling congestion that will help with that, making the passenger experience a better one, etc., etc. But this certainly feeds as a part of that.
I mean, this may be something that the committee will have to come back to in the sense that we won't know whether the cap's been breached till after this, but I think your point is well made. If I can move on to Richard, I think you were next.
Questions, convener, if you allow me. Do we know how many people in Scotland actually have this card?
Yes, I don't have the number right on me, but yes, we do know how many.
I thought I asked the minister.
1.3 million.
Okay. Am I correct in thinking that people who are entitled to use this card may not have used it? I'm entitled to use this card and I have to declare I have it, but I very seldom have used it.
It's correct, but there are, I don't have a figure in front of me, but quite a few people who have the card do not use it. That's correct. Yeah.
Right, last question. Can I also say, I'm led to believe that this scheme does not entitle the bearer, we're in Edinburgh, does not entitle the bearer to free tram travel in Edinburgh, but Edinburgh residents get a reduced tram fare with another card. I mean, you may want mm-hmm. to come back to me.
I can answer that. I mean, again, I can ask Tom to come in if I'm giving you the correct answer here. But, you know, we fund the National Concessionary Travel Scheme for buses. You know, any local scheme is the responsibility of the local authority. So if Edinburgh local authority wishes to allow those who reside in Edinburgh concessionary travel for trams, but nobody outside of Edinburgh, because they would have to fund that, then that is their right to do that. It's not a government scheme. It would be a local authority's responsibility, would that be?
That's correct.
So yeah. Basically, your card just entitles you to go on a bus?
Not just entitles you to go on a bus. It entitles you to go on a bus, travel for free, travel anywhere across Scotland for free. I think that's a pretty good concession that costs us £196 million. It doesn't just allow you to go on a bus.
Can I suggest that we move on, Rick, because we've got quite a few questions here. Rhoda's got one, I think.
Just a very short one. Have you looked at how this will impact on ordinary fares for buses? Will this lead to an increase or should it have no impact at all?
No, certainly shouldn't have an impact on that, and that is part of the discussion with CPT, and the whole point of the fundamental basis of the discussion with the bus industry is that they're no better or no worse off. So if they're no better or no worse off, there should be no reason that the concessionary travel scheme should be the basis for which they increase or decrease fares necessarily. So any increase in fares wouldn't be as a result of the concessionary travel scheme.
Anything else? Jamie, I've got you down next.
Just a small technical question on the cap. If in the scenario that Mike Rumbles mentioned, a theoretical situation where patronage rises perhaps higher than we expect or the forecasts dictate, what happens if we reach the cap? So I guess what is the financial consequence, A, on the bus operators, or B, on the public purse if the cap is reached?
So the cap is reached by a negotiated process, and if the cap was breached, and there has been years where the payments have been higher,
Contractually speaking, it would be for the bus industry. It would be their responsibility. But realistically speaking, you would have to see what the reasons were for the cap being breached. And we know in previous years, as it has been, there's been a late surge towards the end of the year in terms of take up and travel on the National Concessionary Travel Scheme. If I look at the years, over the last 10 years where it was breached, we'd come to discussion with the bus industry and see what's fair and what's not fair and whether we would have to absorb it as a budgetary pressure or whether the bus industry would take that up. I think if we got to that stage and it looked like we were getting towards that stage, we would look at the level where the cap was potentially being breached and then come to a negotiated position. So in some respects, in some years, for example, the breach has been, you know, in around the £1 million mark. So there's been a discussion about, you know, who should absorb that. And I think that's the same approach I would look to take.
I appreciate the answer on that. I think that demonstrates an element of flexibility in the system, which is, in my view, welcomed. However, from signing off the maximum liability to the public purse, I think that's an issue in the sense that it's very difficult to sign off a maximum cap if there's, in your own words, quite a loose setup whereby it may be breached and therefore the public finances may be liable. So I think it's not very clear in terms of the contractual liability there.
I mean, we are the legal obligation to pay is limited to the cap. So if the cap is arrived at during the course of the year, and we try at the beginning of the year to set the cap at a level which we think that won't happen, and that's why we've programmed in this increase. If we reach the cap, then the liability for government is ceases. Right. Any journeys, free journeys undertaken after that point are, in legal terms, for bus operators to provide, and they have to absorb the costs.
Okay.
They understandably don't like that, and it's awkward when it happens, and we try to avoid that happening by setting the cap. We have, on a couple of occasions in the past, permitted accepted claims beyond the cap, as the Minister has said, for various reasons. One was a very late emerging small overshoot, which came up very late in forecasting, and we met that in full. And on another occasion, additional payments were made equivalent to actual claims above the cap as part of a transition when we moved to the new economic model, which basically had quite a depressing effect on payment rates. So there was a transitional relief, if you like, in 1 year.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, the final question is from John.
I mean, it's been argued that maybe more people are going to start using the bus. Sadly, that has not been the case, and certainly in Glasgow, there's been fewer people using the bus. I mean, there is an argument to say that £196 million is really too high, and why should we increase it at all if we're expecting fewer people to use the bus? So, I mean, although there's been an argument on one side, I think there is an argument on the other side if we're trying to be careful with public money. Do you really think we need to increase the 192 to 196?
A number of reasons. I mean, our desire, our ambition as a government is to reverse the decline in bus patronage as a whole. And as I've said to previous members, the National Concessionary Travel Scheme can play a part in that. So it's important that we continue to invest in bus because it's also, there's an element, of course, people will know that the demographics of those who use the bus, the buses can be incredibly, incredibly vital in terms of health benefits, educational benefits, and employment benefits. So I think it's important that we continue to invest.
Okay, we're now going to move on to agenda item 4, which is the subordinate legislation. And that is for formal consideration of the motion calling for the committee to recommend approval of the draft national bus travel concession scheme for older and disabled persons, Amendment Order 2017. I invite the ministers to speak and to move to motion S5M03819. Minister, would you like to move the motion?
Motion to recommend the draft order be approved.
Okay. Are there any further questions by members of the committee? So the question is that motion S5M03819 in the name of Humza Yousaf be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, we are agreed. And that concludes the consideration of the affirmative instrument, and we will report the outcome of the consideration to Parliament. I thank the Minister and your officials for your evidence this morning, and I'd now like to conclude this part of the meeting and suspend it while we move into private session. Thank you, Minister. Thank you.